Well, as I said, tonight's debate really is the conclusion of our broader series called The Jesus Myth, Mythological Portraits of Jesus Christ in the Media and in the Church. And this debate we are referring to as the Mars Hill debate, because Paul, in Acts 17, debated exactly this issue of the resurrection with the Greeks. In fact, in Acts chapters 16 through 18, we see Paul over and over and over again, after he gets kicked out of the synagogues for reasoning with the scriptures with the Jews, he then goes to the word in the Greek literally is debate with the Greeks. And so what we're trying to do here at Antioch is bring back this incredibly biblical model of debate into the church. And specifically, this topic of the resurrection, which was the main issue that Paul was interested in debating in earliest Christianity. And so tonight, we come to ask the question, did Jesus rise from the dead? To my right, we have Dr. Michael Licona defending that Jesus did, in fact, rise from the dead. Dr. Licona is the associate professor in theology at Houston Baptist University. Dr. Licona, in my opinion, is the author of the most definitive, important defense of the resurrection in church history. And yes, that even includes N.T. Wright's book on the resurrection. You can pick up Mike's book out in the foyer. At a table out there, we have copies for sale. Can you please give a warm welcome to Dr. Michael Licona? On my left, we have Dr. Greg Cavin defending that Jesus did not, in fact, rise from the dead. Dr. Cavin is one of the world's experts on miracles and the resurrection. He is a professor of philosophy and religious studies at Cyprus College. He has a PhD in philosophy. He is one of the contributors, anyway, to what many consider to be the most important book-length critique of the resurrection, The Empty Tomb, Jesus Beyond the Grave. Can you please give a warm round of applause and welcome to Dr. Greg Cavin. Well, the format of this evening's debate will be as follows. Each speaker will have 20-minute opening statements. These will be followed by two 12-minute rebuttals and then another to 7-minute rebuttals. And then we get to the interesting part in this evening's debate. We're actually going to have a period of cross-examination where each of the speakers will have the opportunity to examine the other for 5 minutes on weaknesses that they perceive in one another's arguments. And we'll have 3 rounds of this. Mike will lead off and we'll go through 3 5-minute sessions of questioning at the end of the rebuttal period. After that, we will have a time of concluding statements, and we're going to give Dr. Cavin the final word since Mike will be opening. And then following the closing statements, we'll have a time of Q&A from the audience where you in the audience will be given the opportunity to ask your questions live at a Q&A mic in the back. And so stick around for that. That is often one of the most fruitful times of the discussion. If you do have questions or if something's unclear, just jot it down on your insert for notes within your bulletin, and we will address those questions as they come in on the live Q&A mic. There's a number in your bulletins. You can text in your questions. If we don't have enough questions on the mic, which I very seriously doubt, then we'll turn to those text-in questions. So that is the basic format we're going to follow, and Mike is going to lead off with his 20-minute opening statement. Dr. Licona.
Well, thank you very much and good evening, everyone. It is wonderful to be here. I would like to thank Andrew Pitts and the Antioch Church for inviting me to participate in tonight's debate. I've known Andrew for several years now, and I've become increasingly more and more impressed with both the depth and breadth of his knowledge in the field of New Testament studies. And aside from that, he's a pretty cool guy. I mean, I like his character, I like his knowledge, I like his clothes, I like his hair, you know? He's so handsome, he just makes you sick, you know? Anyway, I want to thank Greg Cavin, too. We've had a little discussion prior to the debate, and I'm really looking forward to a collegial time this evening. Well, the question being debated this evening is, did Jesus rise from the dead? This is a question of immense importance, for the truth of the Christian worldview stands or falls on whether this event occurred. The Apostle Paul wrote, "If Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless." Now, I've studied this question for several years as a historian, and I'm going to be approaching it from that vantage point this evening. Before I get started, though, I want briefly to address two matters. The first pertains to our expectations. Historians face the same challenges as archaeologists, geologists, and evolutionary biologists. They can't get into a time machine, return to the past, and verify their conclusions. So they employ method, and they look for the most probable explanation, not absolute certainty, but the most probable explanation. So this evening, my objective is going to be to establish that the resurrection hypothesis is the most probable explanation of the historical data, and thus should be regarded as an event that occurred in history. The second matter pertains to the limitations of historians. Now, historians can determine that Jesus died by crucifixion. However, they have no tools whatsoever for determining whether Jesus' death atones for sin. What possible tool could they have for that? So, of necessity, the hypothesis offered by the historian as historian must be more modest than what the New Testament literature claims about Jesus' death. In a similar manner, historians can, in my opinion, adjudicate on the matter and show that Jesus rose from the dead. However, there's no tools whatsoever for establishing theological components of Jesus' resurrection, such as that his resurrection body has all the eschatological qualities attributed to it in the New Testament literature, such as he could appear and disappear at will, that he, since ascending to heaven, or that he's there, that he's gotten sick or died since. We can't, as historians, do that or say that he's at the right hand of God. There's just no tools historians can use for that. So, of course, my resurrection hypothesis is going to have to be more modest than what the New Testament literature claims of it. So here's how I defined resurrection hypothesis on page 583 of my book and how I'm going to be defending it in this evening's debate. Following a supernatural event of an indeterminate nature and cause, Jesus was raised from the dead and appeared to a number of people in individual and group settings, to friend and foe alike, in no less than an objective vision and perhaps within ordinary vision in his bodily raised corpse. Now, with these two matters stated, I'm now going to construct a positive historical case for Jesus' resurrection using two major building blocks, facts and method. Let's begin with the facts. Now, I'm going to just march off a narrative that I'm borrowing from my friend and mentor, Gary Habermas, and then I'm going to wrap that up with some facts from that. We start with Jesus' death by crucifixion. Historians are pretty unanimous it either happened in April of 30 or April of 33. It's difficult to know which one. It's a toss-up. Slight majority go with April of 30, so that's what I'm going to use this evening. Really doesn't matter. Shortly after that, there was a skeptic, a persecutor of the church named Paul, who had an experience that he interpreted as the risen Jesus appearing to him. The experience radically transformed his life from being a persecutor of the church to one of its most able defenders. It's difficult to date that experience with precision. However, a lot of scholars will place that 1 to 3 years after the crucifixion, let's call it 2 years, and now we're in the year 32. Paul exchanged a lot of letters with the different churches, some of those he established, some he didn't, some to individuals. There are 13 letters attributed to Paul in the New Testament. Scholars are certain that he wrote 7 of them, and the other 6 they debate over. Just to make things simple this evening, I'm only going to be citing from those letters written by Paul that we're certain that Paul actually wrote. One such letter is Paul's letter to the church at Galatia. In Galatians chapter 1, verse 18, Paul says that 3 years after his conversion experience, 35, Paul goes up to Jerusalem and he meets with Peter, the lead apostle there, and spends 15 days with him. And he says he also saw James, the brother of Jesus. It's interesting to note here that the Greek term that Paul uses for meet with Peter is historesai, from which we get the English term history. You see, Paul hadn't walked with Jesus. He wasn't familiar with all of his teachings, so he wanted to get the whole nine yards from one of those who had been, and who better than Peter, the lead apostle. In Galatians 2, Paul says that 14 years later, he went back up to Jerusalem. Text is a little bit ambiguous at this point. We don't know if it's 14 years after his first visit or 14 years after his conversion. So we got to say 11 to 14 years after that, or 16 to 19 years after Jesus' death by crucifixion. That places us somewhere between 46 and 49 AD. Paul says the reason for going back up to Jerusalem was because he wanted to run the gospel message. Remember that gospel message that he'd been preaching all these years. He wanted to run it past the pillars of the church, and he names them Peter, James, and John. Second time meeting with Peter and James, and then throw in John, another of Jesus' closest disciples. He runs it past them because he wants to make sure he's preaching what they're preaching. He says, so that I can ensure I hadn't been working in vain all these years. Paul says that after hearing him, they added nothing to what he had to say. They extended the right hand of fellowship to him. In other words, they said, you're good, Paul. Keep up the good work, brother. So within 16 to 19 years of Jesus' death, Paul says he's preaching the same thing as the Jerusalem apostles were on the gospel message. Now, if all we had was Paul's word on the matter, he might be telling the truth. For all we know, he wasn't. He was lying. So historians look for corroborating data, and we're fortunate that we have it in this instance. Did you know that some of the apostles had disciples of their own? Peter had one named Clement of Rome. John had one named Polycarp. Anyone pregnant in here this evening? Some? Yeah? Well, if you end up having a boy, just remember some of these names, like Polycarp. Okay? Now, if Paul was teaching heresy, we would expect Clement and Polycarp, who wrote letters that we still have, to chide and correct Paul on this. Not only do they not correct or chide Paul or speak poorly of him in any way, they speak very laudatory of him. For example, Clement places Paul on par with his mentor Peter. Polycarp says that Paul, and I quote, accurately and reliably taught the message of truth, both right after Paul's death. So this corroborates. We got Paul saying they said he was teaching what they were teaching, and then we have two of the Peter and John's disciples saying, "Yep, Paul was teaching the word of truth. He's teaching what they're teaching." So the nice part about this is when we're talking about the gospel message, then we can be certain when we're hearing Paul on the matter, we're likewise hearing the voice of the Jerusalem apostles. That's 46 to 49 AD. A few years later, Paul goes up to an ancient Mediterranean city named Corinth, and he starts a church there, the First Baptist Church of Corinth. And after establishing a church, he leaves, he goes and establishes new churches. And around the year 55, he writes a letter back to the church at Corinth in answer to some of their questions. That letter we have is called 1 Corinthians. We're going to spend a little time in that letter. Just to give you an idea, though, where the Gospels are, and I'm not really going to even be using the Gospels this evening. And Mark, we don't know exactly when they're written. 99.9% of all New Testament scholars would say that they're all written in the first century. The standard dating, and these are disputed, is Mark is written in the year 65 to 70. Matthew a little after that, Luke a little after that, John between 90 and 95. So 35 to 65 years after the crucifixion of Jesus. Relatively recent by ancient standards. The point I want to make, though, is 1 Corinthians and Paul's letters, and 1 Corinthians is one of the latter ones that we'll be using, 1 Corinthians is written at least a decade, if not longer, before the first gospel's written. Now, in chapter 15, Paul says, verse 1, I want to remind you, Corinthians, of the gospel message that I preached to you and by which you were saved and continue as Christians. Wow, the gospel message, the very gospel message that he had endorsed by the apostles back here, and that Clement and Polycarp said Paul was teaching the word of truth. He's about to give us this gospel message. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the kind of stuff historians dream of having. We're getting what the Jerusalem apostles were teaching, certifiably what they were teaching. Here's what Paul says. He says, I delivered to you what I also received. Now remember, when did he deliver it to them? This is 55. He delivered it to them in 51 when he set up the church, and he received it before then. And of course, he's getting this from the Jerusalem apostles. I delivered to you what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared, and he lists six post-resurrection appearances, to Peter, to the 12, to more than 500, to James, to all the apostles, and then Paul adds his own name to the list. Three individual appearances, Peter and James, he'd already met with them twice, remember, and then Paul, and then three group appearances. The group appearances are important because this strongly suggests that these aren't hallucinations, since modern psychology suggests that group hallucinations are extremely rare, if not impossible. Now, a little about the nature of the appearances. Paul doesn't mention an empty tomb. So if I'm not using the Gospels this evening, how do we get, what Paul was teaching and the apostles teaching about resurrection? A couple verses later in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 20, Paul says, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep. In other words, Christ is the first to be raised from the dead in a resurrection body that wouldn't die, that was immortal, all these kinds of really neat things that he could do. This is what they're teaching. When's everybody else going to be raised? Believers? Paul answers that three verses later. He says, each in his own order. Christ the first fruits, after that those who belong to him at his coming. So Jesus is raised in the year 30 or 33. Everybody else, when Jesus returns. What happens to believers in the meantime? Paul answers that elsewhere. 2 Corinthians 5, he says, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Philippians 1, he says, you can die and be with Christ or remain in the body. So the idea we have here with Paul, and he also says the same thing pretty much in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, is that when a person dies, their body is buried, their spirit leaves their body and goes to be with Jesus in heaven and exists with him as a disembodied spirit. When Jesus returns, he brings the spirits back, puts them back in the corpses, resurrects the corpses, and transforms them into an immortal, glorious, powerful body that's animated by the Holy Spirit. And so it's a physical, bodily resurrection. And if Christ is the first fruits of the dead, and Jesus was raised, and we're going to be raised physically, that means Jesus was raised physically. So let me wrap it up. Here's what we have with our from the narrative. This is what we have from the narrative. I'm going to give you four facts. Four facts. Fact number one is that just after, and you can put the facts up now, just after Jesus' death, shortly thereafter, a number of his followers had experiences they interpreted as appearances of the risen Jesus. Number two, these experiences occurred in both individual and in group settings. Number three, there was a skeptic and persecutor of the church named Paul who likewise had an experience he interpreted as an appearance of the risen Jesus to him. And four, the nature of these experiences were such that they believed that Jesus had been raised physically, bodily, from the dead. These are the four facts I'm going to be using this evening. And we can see they have very strongly attested historically. This leads us then to my second major building block, method. What do we do with these facts? Well, as I stated a few minutes ago, historians can't get into a time machine and verify their conclusions. So they employ arguments of inference to the best explanation and use four general criteria for assessing hypotheses in this manner. The first criterion is explanatory scope. This states the hypothesis accounting for the greatest number of relevant facts is to be preferred. In our case, the resurrection hypothesis accounts for all four facts, and thus it easily passes this criterion. The second is explanatory power. Given the truth of the hypothesis, would we expect to see our data at hand? Well, if Jesus rose from the dead in confirmation of his claims, we would expect all four facts. Thus, the resurrection hypothesis easily passes this criterion as well. The third criterion is less ad hoc. Ad hoc is a Latin term meaning for this. And a hypothesis is ad hoc when it's contrived. And we recognize a hypothesis as being ad hoc when there are no reasons for thinking it true other than it explains the facts. Now, every hypothesis has a degree of ad hocness, so we're looking for the one that is the least ad hoc. To illustrate, we can account for the four facts I've just provided by postulating that undetectable gremlins from Saturn visited the Earth in the early part of the first century. They thought Jesus was self-deluded, but they were appalled by what the Roman and Jewish leaders had done to him. So they reanimated his corpse, got inside, and spoke through him to convince others he'd been raised from the dead in order to get back at the leaders. Now, the gremlin hypothesis has fine explanatory scope and power. However, it's terribly ad hoc because it's contrived and there's no reasons for thinking it true other than it explains the facts. Well, in comparison, to what degree is the resurrection hypothesis ad hoc? Not very much. The four facts I presented earlier occur in a context charged with religious significance. At the very minimum, this context consists of three facts. Number one, Jesus claimed to have a special relationship with God. Two, Jesus taught that God had chosen him to usher in his kingdom. And three, Jesus performed deeds that awed crowds and that both he and his followers regarded as divine miracles and exorcisms. All three of these facts are so strongly evidenced that they are virtually undisputed by historians of Jesus today. Thus, within this context, if you had lived in the first century and seen Jesus within this context, and you saw him executed, and then a few days later you saw him alive, you would normally conclude that he'd been raised from the dead. And thus, this hypothesis, the resurrection hypothesis, is not contrived, and the ad hoc component is minimum. The fourth criterion is plausibility. This criterion assesses the degree to which a hypothesis is compatible with our background knowledge. The hypothesis that the disciples experienced mass hallucinations is incompatible with our background knowledge relative to psychological phenomena, since the mental health profession regards group hallucinations as being extremely rare, if not impossible. Thus, the mass hallucination hypothesis is implausible. What about the resurrection hypothesis? Well, our background knowledge relative to science and medicine informs us that the dead do not return to life unassisted or by natural causes. We know that. However, the resurrection hypothesis is that Jesus was assisted by a supernatural cause. And there's no scientific or medical knowledge that would tell us that a supernatural being could not raise Jesus from the dead, in other words, assisted. To illustrate this important nuance, consider the plausibility of the statement that Ralph walked on lukewarm water unassisted. Well, we know that's implausible given the laws of nature. But suppose we change that hypothesis to Ralph walked on water assisted, and that Ralph is a three-year-old, his dad has held his hands above his head, supporting his weight completely, and held him over a swimming pool, allowing him to walk on water. That changes everything. And what applied to Ralph unassisted does not apply to him assisted. The same applies to the resurrection of Jesus. Of course it's implausible to say he was raised from the dead unassisted or by natural causes. But that's not the resurrection hypothesis. So the resurrection hypothesis is not implausible. But is it plausible? Well, over the past several months, I've come to believe that it is. I've wrestled with this over several years and tried to be fair with myself on this. But arguing such, the positive plausibility would take more time than I have in my 20-minute opening statement. So due to time limitations, I'm going to be content this evening to argue that the resurrection hypothesis is not implausible. But even then, the resurrection hypothesis still passes three of the four criteria with flying colors and doesn't fail the fourth. Now, that's far more than can be said about competing hypotheses, none of which can fulfill the criteria as well as the resurrection hypothesis. Now, of course, I don't have time to deal with all naturalistic hypotheses this evening and defend the resurrection or build a positive case as well. I have addressed the ridiculous one, the gremlin hypothesis, and a popular one, the mass hallucinations. So in conclusion, I want to issue a challenge to Greg this evening. I challenge him to present and defend what he thinks happened to Jesus. I can't deal with them all, but I can deal with his naturalistic hypothesis. Tell us what he thinks, defend it, and I can guarantee the resurrection hypothesis will still come on top, because by far it is the best historical explanation of the data and thus should be regarded as an event that occurred in history. Thank you.
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank you for inviting me to come and be in this debate. I'd like to thank Mike for agreeing to be in the debate. And I'd like to thank Andrew and Chris for arranging this and putting it all together. I think it's wonderful that your church is a very intellectual church and is probing these issues and questioning and debating. So I think you owe yourself a round of applause for being this kind of church. Then I'd like to also ask you this. How many of you in the room are Christians tonight? Just show of hands. So the vast majority.
Let's turn to Jesus.
Are there any skeptics
in
the audience?
Train it a gnat and
swallow
a camel.
Okay.
Let's talk about the argument of the resurrection.
Be on my side
now.
When
you look at Mike's argument tonight, you're going to see him doing just this, straining at gnats while swallowing whole camels. Let's talk about the resurrectionist. Hey, Jones, look, there's a gnat in your soup. But Smith...
I see. Yeah, I see. There's a camel in the resurrectionist soup. I'm going to talk tonight about 15 deadly camels of the resurrection. And the first one I'm going to talk about now is the skeptic falsely assumes that God does not exist, and therefore the skeptic's skepticism about the resurrection is unjustified. This is not an issue tonight in this debate. It's a myth. The existence of God is not an issue, as St. Paul himself called it. It's a false stumbling block. It's a red herring. I'm going to assume tonight not only that the God of Western traditional theism exists, I'm going to assume that he's been proven to exist. So that's simply going to be a non-issue in our debate. Turn to camel number two, that the resurrection cannot occur by purely natural means. In fact, that's wrong. Let's take a look at the resurrectionist and his argument. Resurrection from the dead by purely natural means has super low prior probability. But my hypothesis is that Jesus was raised from the dead supernaturally. I can show you easily that resurrection from the dead by natural means is not improbable at all. In fact, it's simply a matter of moving atoms in the body from their dead state to their living state. In fact, this is being worked on right now by Alcor in Scottsdale, Arizona. You can actually buy for $50,000 a stainless steel tube, they'll put you in it, and they'll raise you from the dead later in the future when they have the medical nanotechnology to do it. So natural resurrection from the dead is not by any means impossible or unlikely. Behold, natural resurrection via what we might call the Christenstein machine. Who knows? Let's turn to, I think, what Mike's main objection is going to be. I call this divine interference objection. The skeptic wrongly ignores God's supernatural action in history by saying the resurrection has a low prior probability. Let's take a look at the argument the resurrectionist gives. You skeptics ignore God, but prior probability must be based on God's supernatural power. The 100 billion people who've died and stay dead prove at most that when God does not intervene, the dead stay dead. However, if God wanted to raise Jesus, then it's 100% probable that the resurrection would occur. Consider an analogy, floating above water in your swimming pool. So look, here I am floating above water in my swimming pool. Mike wants to say skeptics dismiss this because they exclude the possibility of God as an external agent. They say accountability. I think I just lost my microphone. But all bets are off, Mike says, if we take into account God's supernatural power as an external agent. So look, here's an external agent holding me up from the water, right? That certainly is possible. Likewise, Mike says, you can't say that a resurrection has a low prior probability because doing so ignores the supernatural intervention of God. Well, he says you employ too far of a simplistic manner of determining prior probabilities by leaving out God. What's more, Mike says, God is a free agent, and as a free agent, we can't know a priori what it is that God would will to do. Because of this, we're forced to say the prior probability of the resurrection, Mike says, is inscrutable. So finally, there's a challenge. The challenge is this. If the prior probability of the resurrection is low, then I, the skeptic, need to give the necessary background information to show, in fact, that it is low. Well, I say to this, no problem. Okay, I'm going to show you right now. I agree that God is all-powerful. I agree he's all-knowing. I agree he's morally perfect. I agree that he can supernaturally intervene in the world any way he wants to. However, that is irrelevant. God made the laws of science. He can overturn them when he wants to. They have no power over him. All that's true. So then how can I say that the resurrection of Jesus by God as a supernatural event, not a natural event, but as a supernatural event, has a low prior probability? Well, it's very easy. Well, possibility is not probability. Second of all, if does not mean does. If God wills that I turn into a gigantic green cucumber, then indeed I will turn into a gigantic green cucumber. But it's very unlikely that God will such a thing. The problem here is that God can super intervene. The fact that he can doesn't mean that it's likely that he will. So let's return to Mike's swimming pool analogy. Take a look at the pictures here. It's not unlikely for me to be able to float on the water by buoyancy on my own. That's possible, very likely. And even though it's possible, it's not very likely that someone's going to pick me up and carry me in the water, letting me float above the area of the water. That's possible, but not very likely. Observation shows that the frequency of external agents lifting me out of the water is very low indeed. And while it's scientifically possible, believe it or not, for me to float above the water without physical support, it's very, very unlikely that this would happen. And probability theory shows that this is even more unlikely if God were to cause it to happen. So there's the hand of God. That's even more unlikely yet. We now have an event that is astronomically improbable, a supernatural action. It's a blatant straw man, by the way, to say that we have to determine what God would do by a priori means. The problem with Mike is that he ignores God's self-revelation through nature. We can determine a posteriori by looking at nature what God will do. To see why supernatural intervention by God is antecedently improbable, we have to look at two things, natural theology and specifically at the via negativa, the way of negation. So let's turn to St. Augustine of Hippo, who said, nature is the will of God. There it is in Latin. Most Maimonides, a great Jewish theologian, added that we can know about God by seeing what he does not do, what he's not, by the via negativa, the way of negation. We learn about God by seeing what he is not. So God's self-revelation in nature shows that he has an exceptionally strong tendency not to interfere supernaturally in the course of nature. We hardly ever see God intervening supernaturally. God removes himself from the situation. We can see more specifically God reveals every day in our everyday experience and in science that he possesses an exceptionally strong tendency not to supernaturally raise dead people from the dead. I know so far of no dead people who God has raised from the dead in my own life. Since whatever God wills to happen must happen, it follows that the antecedent probability that God would will that Jesus rise from the dead is astronomically low. And since God is omnibenevolent, it follows he must have the best reasons for choosing not to raise Jesus from the dead. All right. This enables me to form the following anti-resurrection prior probability argument. Let's take a look at it. 99.9999999% of the dead are not supernaturally interfered with by God, and he does not raise them from the dead. Jesus was dead, so it's virtually certain that Jesus was not supernaturally raised from the dead by God. There you have it. A supernatural resurrection of Jesus from the dead by God has an extremely low prior probability. This is an instance of a very important kind of argument form called statistical syllogism. Okay, I'm going to have to step back because I can't read this very well, and I have to do, you'll have to bear with me here. Let me talk briefly why I think the resurrection is not a very good explanation. This is camel number four. Resurrections say the resurrection is a good explanation. I want to argue that it's not. There are four major problems here. First of all, as to resurrection theory becomes a viciously circular explanation. Suppose we ask, why did individuals and groups, both friends and foes, experience appearances in objective visions or with an ordinary vision of Jesus in his bodily raised corpse? And suppose we're told that's simple. I explain the fact that these people experienced these appearances of Jesus by means of the resurrection hypothesis, which I explicitly define as the hypothesis that these very same people had these very same experiences. If someone gave an argument like that, we would call it blatantly circular. And that is exactly what Mike has done. Let's take a look at his definition here. I define the resurrection hypothesis as follows. Following a supernatural event of an indeterminate nature and cause, notice what he says. Jesus appeared to a number of people in individual and group settings, and to friends and foes, and no less in an objective vision, and perhaps with ordinary vision, in his bodily raised corpse. All he's telling you is that these people had these experiences because these people had these experiences. It's a viciously circular explanation. It's logical. Illogical. You cannot define the resurrection theory in terms of the facts you're trying to explain the way Mike has done. So I'm going to challenge him tonight to give me a non-circular explanation of why the appearances in the empty tomb occurred. This leads to our second problem for the resurrection theory. Once you no longer define it as a circular explanation, you'll see it completely lacks explanatory scope and explanatory power. To see this, let's look at the parable of Mr. Jones. Let us suppose that Jones' house is found empty by Peter, John, and the two Marys. Let's suppose later that morning, James Jones is seen by the two Marys. Later that day, Jones is seen at the club by his employees. And 3 years later, Jones is seen up in the clouds skydiving. Now, suppose we ask, why was Jones' house found empty? And someone says to us, well, that's simple. It's because Jones woke up. Well, we would reject that as a completely preposterous explanation. That's no explanation. To explain why Jones' house is found empty, we'd have to say that he left his house. Now, suppose we ask why Jones was seen by the two Marys, and we're told, well, that's easy. It's because he woke up. Again, that is a completely wrong explanation. It doesn't tell us what we need to know. We have to suppose that he encountered them to be able to explain why they saw him. Let's suppose we ask why Jones was seen by his employees at the club, and we're told yet again, well, that's simple. It's a snap because Jones woke up. Well, again, that's a completely bogus explanation. To explain why he was seen at the club, we have to again suppose that Jones encountered his employees at the club. And suppose now we ask why Jones was seen skydiving 3 years later, and suppose we're told, well, that's obvious. It's because Jones woke up 3 years earlier. We would completely dismiss this as a ridiculous explanation. Okay, so here we'd have to suppose Jones jumped out of an airplane to explain what we're trying to explain. So let's suppose what we're really trying to explain here is not Jones skydiving, but something entirely different. Let's say Jones was seen floating above the clouds in heaven in resplendent glory. And let's suppose we ask someone, well, what's the explanation for this? And they say, well, that's obvious. It's because Jones woke up. Well, we would say that is absolutely preposterous, utterly. We would say we have to explain why Jones is floating in the clouds in glory, and we have no explanation of that. And you can see the resurrectionist is doing exactly this with the resurrection theory. Here's the moral of my parable. The hypothesis that Jesus rose from the dead can no more explain the empty tomb and the appearances to the witnesses than can the hypothesis that Jones rose from his bed explain his empty house and the appearances he made later that day and 3 years later. For the resurrection theory to explain the empty tomb and the appearances, we're going to add assumptions. We're going to add more than the resurrection theory. We're going to have to talk about the post-mortem activities of Jesus, that he actually went out and found the women, that he went to the disciples, that somehow he was able to ascend up into the sky, up into heaven, and appear from there. In fact, we'll have to add at least two hypotheses to the resurrection theory, that Jesus could ascend, and that somehow once he got up there, wherever heaven is, he was able to figure out what was going down on earth, and once he knew that, he was able to produce visions of glory of himself up in heaven. Well, we can see that left to its own devices, the resurrection theory lacks explanatory power and explanatory scope. The bare resurrection theory alone is not sufficient. We have to add more to it. That leads me to the third problem of the resurrection theory. The resurrection theory is extremely ad hoc in exactly the way Mike was talking about, because these assumptions that have to be added to it are not entailed, they're not implied by the resurrection theory, nor are they implied by our existing knowledge. They are completely additions that are highly improbable and questionable. My fourth problem for the resurrection theory. Let's suppose we go back to Mike's definition of the resurrection, but strip it now of those features that make it viciously circular. What we're left with is this: a supernatural event of an indeterminate nature and cause involving Jesus as a bodily raised corpse. That's all we have left once we take out the parts that make it a viciously circular explanation. Here's the problem. The problem now is that the resurrection theory becomes so indeterminate, we really don't know what to say about Jesus. Jesus becomes a veritable X-man on Mike's theory. We don't know what an indeterminate cause is. Is he composed of atoms, or is he composed of some unknown something else that, for lack of a better term, we can call schmatoms? What I want to give you, my atoms and schmatoms explanatory dilemma. What I want to argue is that there are two possibilities. On the one hand, we could say that Jesus was composed of atoms. On the positive side, that meant he could interact with the physical world. He can be seen, heard, touched, pick up meat, eat fish. He can move about without passing through other people's bodies, things like that. He can be seen by Mary Magdalene, for instance. And the disciples and to Paul. Yet the question resurrectionists can't answer is how this is supposed to explain it. So far they've not done this. Mike's not done it yet. He's assumed, but he's not explained. There are only two possibilities here. Both possibilities fail. The first one is, as I said, Horn 1 atoms. I want to ask Mike tonight, is the body of Jesus made out of atoms, the resurrected body? If it is, we have big problems in explaining the appearance to Paul. A body of atoms cannot explain the appearance to Paul. It can't really explain the other appearances as well. On the positive side, as I said, a body of atoms can interact with the physical world, but on the negative side, we have that someone who is made of atoms is physically weak. They're subject to injury, decay, to aging. They're mortal. They'll die again. And the thing is, they'll know all this. They know they're stuck to the earth. They know they can't go up to heaven. So imagine now if Jesus had simply been resurrected by God supernaturally with atoms. Then he would not be the triumphant Savior we see in the Gospels. He would know that he could die again. He would know as soon as he gets out into Jerusalem, it's over for him a second time. He's not going to be any kind of triumphant Savior. He's not going to appear to the disciples the way he did. He's not going to walk through doors through them. He's not going to disappear from Emmaus and appear in the upper room. He's not going to ascend up to heaven and appear to Paul 3 years later. None of this can be explained if you assume that Jesus was made out of atoms. Plus, even if he weren't killed by the Romans, Jesus would soon die again by natural causes. You would not have Christianity the way you have it today. The resurrection theory on a Jesus made of atoms has no explanatory power. It has no explanatory scope. Get around this, you have to add ad hoc hypotheses that are not entailed by the resurrection theory as Mike stated it, as something that is indeterminate, nor can you explain it by adding in the ad hoc hypotheses because they're not accounted for, they're not implied by our existing knowledge. Let's turn to the second part of my dilemma. Well, I didn't have time to talk about this. Even if you assume Jesus was made of atoms, it doesn't mean that he was made in human form of atoms. So you could have alien Jesus, you could have beast Jesus. And the point is, there's nothing in Mike's hypothesis that tells us the form in which Jesus was resurrected. Mike's hypothesis is that an indeterminate cause, indeterminate nature, right, appeared to these people. So if you have something that's indeterminate, you can't say what form it will take. So you can't say it has explanatory power. The only way Mike can get around this is by saying it's no longer indeterminate by having specific features the risen Jesus has. It's not enough to say he simply became back to life again. He has to be more concrete. So I'll stop at this point, pick it up when I have my next 12 minutes.
Well, at this time, we are going to move into the rebuttal phase of the debate. And Mike is going to start out with a 12-minute rebuttal to Greg's opening statement. Welcome, Dr. Mike Licona, again to the podium.
Well, thank you, Greg. In my opening statement, I constructed a positive historical case for Jesus' resurrection using two major building blocks, facts and method. I'd like now to review that case in light of what Greg just offered. Let's begin with my facts, and here I offered four. Number one, shortly after Jesus' death, a number of his followers had experiences. Do you need me to stay in the middle? They had experience that they interpreted as the risen Jesus appearing to them. Two, these experiences occurred in both individual and in group settings. Three, Paul, a skeptic and persecutor of the church, also had an experience he interpreted as the risen Jesus appearing to him. And four, the nature of their experiences was such that they believed that Jesus had been raised physically, bodily from the dead. Now, all four of those facts went uncontested in Greg's opening statement. And so I don't know what he thinks about them, but for purposes of this evening's debate, they still stand. This leads us then to my second major building block, method. And here I contended that historians employ arguments of inference to the best explanation and employ the four criteria for the best explanation to assess hypotheses to see which is the best one. These are explanatory scope, explanatory power, less ad hoc, and plausibility. And this is where Greg takes issue with my case this evening. I had argued that the resurrection hypothesis fulfills these better than any other naturalistic hypothesis. Let's see how he responded. First of all, in terms of explanatory scope and power, he gives the example of Jones waking up and going parachuting, falling out of the sky. He says that this is pretty similar to the resurrection hypothesis, but it has to assume too much in terms of Jesus, that he's in heaven and all of this stuff, and so it lacks explanatory scope and power. Assuming, if I was making any assumptions about Jesus being in heaven, that he's looking down and he wants to appear to people in visions and all this, that wouldn't be explanatory scope and power. That would be ad hoc, so he's confusing the criterion here. It doesn't lack explanatory scope because, as he pointed out, the Jones thing, it does cover all that. The Jones hypothesis that he woke up would have explanatory scope, would have explanatory power. And so does the resurrection hypothesis. It is the kind of things that we would expect if Jesus was raised, say, physically, bodily from the dead. But what about the ad hoc criterion? He says, well, it's ad hoc because we have to assume too much. Things like Jesus was comprised of atoms, but then you have to assume that they were atoms rather than schmatoms. And I guess we can call Webster and give you a new term there. So he says, because of this, we can't conclude that Jesus' body could do all these wonderful things, that it's in heaven today, that it's immortal, glorious, and so forth. This is what his essay in that book was about. And he's right, I didn't respond to it. I hadn't read that essay, I'm embarrassed to say, at that point when I wrote my dissertation. But I think it's still a very, very weak argument. Do you recall that I said in my opening statement that just like historians can't, they can show that Jesus died by crucifixion, but they can't show his death atones for sins, and therefore their hypothesis about Jesus' death of necessity must be more modest than what the New Testament literature claims of it. So we can say Jesus died by crucifixion, but we can't say, as historians, that his death atones for sins. We don't deny it, we just can't affirm it as historians. The same applies here, and this is, I think, is just a devastating critique of Greg's entire essay, which I just think is just completely mistaken. Historians don't have to verify everything that the New Testament says in order to verify some things. Historians can verify lots about Jesus in the New Testament. I gave three facts that virtually 100% of scholars studying Jesus today acknowledge, whether they be Jewish, agnostic, atheist, liberal, conservative, Christian, they all acknowledge that Jesus performed deeds that all the crowds and that he and his followers regarded as divine miracles and exorcisms, that he taught in parables, that he was a traveling itinerant Jewish preacher, and a number of things, that he thought he had a relationship, special relationship with God, that God had chosen him as his agent to usher in his kingdom. These are virtually acknowledged, all these things, by 100% of New Testament scholarship today, even very skeptical ones. So they can verify these things by learning from the New Testament literature, and they don't accept the resurrection, but they would accept these other things. So I'm saying you got to have, as historians, we have more modest hypotheses. I think as a historian that we can verify that Jesus was raised from the dead. I think that we can show this. I think we can show it was a supernatural cause. We know this doesn't happen by natural causes, contrary to what Greg said. He said he was going to offer an argument. We never heard that. So people don't come back by natural causes from the dead, especially executed people. You don't have any scourged and crucified person who dies and then comes back from the dead naturally. That's implausible. Such a hypothesis would fail the plausibility criterion. It wouldn't be what we would expect. So it fails the ad hoc or the explanatory power. It would have explanatory scope. Well, it wouldn't even have that because it wouldn't explain how the disciples and Paul came to believe Jesus had been raised physically. You got to remember, if Jesus was raised naturally, not by a supernatural cause, he came back to life after being scourged and crucified, think of what he would look like. Do you think he's going to convince them that he had been raised in an immortal resurrection body? Peter's saying, gosh, Jesus, I can't wait to have a resurrection body just like yours. You know, that's not going to happen. So it doesn't have explanatory scope. It doesn't have explanatory power. It's terribly ad hoc. It's completely contrived. And I've just showed that it's implausible. The natural resuscitation or resurrection hypothesis fails every criterion for the best explanation, whereas the resurrection hypothesis passes three of the four with flying criteria and doesn't fail the fourth. Now, Greg says, so he does say the natural resuscitation or resurrection hypothesis is not unlikely. I really look forward to hearing his reasons for that. Greg then says that it's unlikely that God would raise Jesus from the dead because God gives us self-revelation through nature. Well, it seems to me that this makes one terrible non-evidenced assumption. It assumes that God, creating natural law, would have chosen to always work and give us revelation through nature. Maybe Greg can give us some reasons for this. I don't see any reason why this would be the case. It also assumes that God wouldn't have any reasons whatsoever for overriding the natural laws he created. Well, I can think of one real quickly. Maybe he would override the laws of nature in order to get the attention of humans who are just going to be looking at nature and, whoa, a miracle happened here? Look, yep, God did it, and he does it to get his message across. So we can see that there'd be a very plausible reason for why God would override his law. So there's no reason to believe that he's only going to give us revelation or speak to us through natural law. Then Greg says, he talks about relative frequency. We don't see God raising people from the dead. There have been 100 billion people estimated to live and die on our earth. And we don't, bracketing Jesus at least, we don't have any good evidence of God raising any of those. And so therefore the prior probability of Jesus being raised from the dead is, let's say, 1 in 100 billion or something like that, 1 chance in 100 billion. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a really bizarre way of calculating probability when it comes to historical investigation. This is why historians don't do these kinds of things with these kind of statistical inferences. Imagine if historians were to do that with the hypothesis that the U.S. dropped nuclear bombs on Japan in World War II. In all of human history, how many nuclear bombs have one nation dropped on another prior to World War II or after? It's never happened. So would we therefore say that the prior probability of the U.S. dropping nuclear bombs on Japan is 1 chance in 100 billion? Of course not. That's an insane way of doing history. Not saying you're insane, friend. Not saying it. It's just a crazy way of doing history. Historians don't do that. We would look at the evidence. There's the claim the U.S. dropped nuclear bombs on Japan in World War II. All right, what's the evidence? We assess the evidence, and then we look at different hypotheses, and we choose a hypothesis that best explains the evidence. Prior probabilities don't work in this way. Besides, even if we were to use a prior probability, they're often easily overcome by evidence. Imagine that we have a ferry that has successfully crossed the Mississippi River tens of thousands of times without incident during the past 50 years. One day, let's say I'm down by the river and I see a guy with a sad face. And he tells me that he just saw the ferry sink and all of its passengers carried downstream. The prior probability established by tens of thousands of successful crossings without a single incident is easily overcome by just a slight amount of testimony. Again, ladies and gentlemen, historians don't use this kind of probability for historical hypotheses. They use arguments of inference to the best explanation, and we've seen how the resurrection hypothesis fulfills three of the four criteria with flying colors and doesn't fail the fourth. Remember, explanatory scope is you got to account for all the facts. Resurrection hypothesis does that. Explanatory powers, given the truth of the hypothesis, would we expect these? In other words, does it account for the facts without forcing them to fit? Well, of course not. The resurrection hypothesis goes hand in glove with those four facts. That Jesus, that a number of people thought that he had been raised and appeared to them, individual, group settings, friend and foe alike, and they thought he'd been raised physically, bodily from the dead in a resurrection, immortal body. That fits hand in glove. Is it ad hoc? Again, not within the context, if we consider the context in which all this occurs. It's kind of like saying this. Say we got a blind man walking down the street with his wife. He's been born blind, never seen, never prayed for a sight. He's an atheist. And all of a sudden he gets a sight. Is that a miracle? I tend to think not. It's just an anomaly. But let's suppose, same scenario, same guy, atheist, born blind, never prayed for a sight, walking down the street with his wife, and a guy walks up to him, a total stranger, and says, in the name of Jesus, you will now see. And at that point, he gets a sight. Is that a miracle? I think so. But what's the difference between the two? The latter occurs in a context charged with religious significance. It's more than just coincidence. And so this is not ad hoc in any way because the evidence for Jesus' resurrection occurs in such a context as this. And again, it's not implausible. Because there's nothing in science and medicine that says that someone can, a supernatural cause cannot raise someone else from the dead. So we can still see then, therefore, that not only do my facts stand, but the method is still in place and the resurrection hypothesis remains the best explanation for the historical data and thus should be regarded as an event that occurred in history. Thank you.
I'm going to put the computer up here because I don't like looking at the side screens. Is that okay? I want to say that Mike has not responded to my specifics. I pointed out that God has a strong tendency not to raise the dead. His attempt to refute that was by saying it's possible God could raise the dead. Well, of course, it's possible. That's not the issue. The issue is God has an exceptionally strong tendency to raise the dead, to not to raise the dead, and to not intervene supernaturally Mike has not addressed that. Let's talk about horn number two, which I call schmadams. We don't know what schmadams are. Look at the picture there, my little graphic. Schmadams are a complete unknown. Mike talks about Jesus being transformed into some wholly other kind of life. Maybe he's outside of space-time. Maybe so. Maybe he's the soma pneumaticon talked about St. Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, an imperishable body that cannot die, cannot age, that is strong, weak, powerful, strong and powerful. But let's say that's right. There is no way to guesstimate from the indefinite theory that Mike gives us which of these possibilities is correct. If you have an indeterminate cause, you can't say whether it's atoms, you can't say whether it's schmadams. You simply can't say one way or the other. And because you can't say, you have to look at both possible explanations. So the atoms explanation is very weak indeed. What about schmadams? Well, what does a risen body look like? Maybe it looks like this on the schmadams definition. Maybe it looks like something like this. Right? Mike gives us an indefinite theory. Does the risen Jesus look anything at all like a man? Now, of course, Mike can change his theory tonight. I ask him to do that and tell us that the risen Jesus looked like he looked like when he was a man on earth. But his indefinite hypothesis can't do this. Maybe schmadams, Jesus looks like this. Now, here's the point. There's no way to even guesstimate what kind of effects what Jesus, Madam's Jesus, would do if he were raised this way by God. We have no idea what he would be, no idea what he would do. This leads to a very negative consequence. Here's Mary trying to... Madam's don't interact with the real world, right? Light will pass right through Madam Jesus, so the disciples, Mary, would not be able to see him in the first place. So here we have an explanatory power of exactly zero. No explanation at all. What we have here is the true X-man hypothesis. If you have an indefinite theory, you have an X-man. You can't say what the risen Jesus is one way or the other. Again, I ask Mike tonight and I challenge him to specify what the risen Jesus actually is and tell us how Jesus is able to be seen and touched and heard by the disciples and the women and Paul. Is he made out of atoms? Did they actually see light? Or is he made out of schmadams and it's some special supernatural power given by God? So far, Mike does not have an explanation of the appearances or the empty tomb because he did not explain to us how Jesus is able to be perceived by the different people. Here you have no explanation at all, and I want to flip over to the slide. You have a probability of zero in the second case. So either way, whether you go atoms or schmadams, we have a very weak explanation for the empty tomb and the appearances. So here I have a graphic showing you the probability of the tomb and the appearances on our X-man theory, which is equal to this. The first of those two terms are unknowns. One is very zero. When you put all that together, the power and scope put together of the resurrection theory is simply very low and unknown exactly how low it is. But it's certainly not high the way Mike thinks it is. Mike thinks the resurrection theory alone satisfies the criteria of adequacy. I say that's a myth. Let's take a look at a chart from Mike's book. He looks at all these other theories, and then he finally looks at the resurrection theory. He says, pass, 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 all the way through. What I've shown is that the resurrection theory cannot account for Paul. It lacks scope. It can't account for the appearance to the disciples because we don't know what the risen Jesus was. The same thing for the women. We don't have scope for the same reason we don't have power. I showed that the resurrection theory is highly mechanics. Statistical mechanics tells us that microstates having the same energy have the same a priori probability. In fact, this is known as the postulate of equal a priori probabilities. Mike does not talk about this in his book. Now, the name equal a priori probabilities is a misnomer. That makes it sound like it's all a priori. It's not. The principle is actually a very well empirically confirmed postulate that explains a great wealth of data from various branches of science. So even though it's called the principle of equal a priori probabilities, it's actually a a posteriori principle. Now, statistical mechanics tells us this. It tells us even if God has a chosen people, he has no chosen microstates. And what I mean by that is all microstates having the same energy have exactly the same degree of probability. God does not change that. Now, the microstates of the corpse of Jesus, together with its surroundings, were of equal energy because all that Jesus and his surroundings did was interchange energy between themselves in the form of heat, work, things like that. But the equal probable microstates in which the corpse of Jesus is dead vastly outnumber those in which he is alive. So if you look at the graphic up here, or over here, you'll see microstates of death, okay? That's where the body is being decompartmentalized. Over here you see microstates of life, that's where the body remains compartmentalized. There are gazillions of microstates of death and decomposition, but there's relatively few microstates of life. In fact, look at my graphic. You'll see right now a living person compartmentalized. Gradually, he dies, and deep compartmentalization takes place. Each of those microstates has the same probability. Right? Watch it again. You'll see a hole open up in the head, and eventually everything spills out. You get equilibrium. Now let's look at a resurrection. You begin with equilibrium, and God supernaturally caused the particles to come and form a human being again, right? A living human being, not a dead human being. The problem here is that if all microstates have the same equal a priori probability, then because there are gazillions of more microstates of death and decomposition and relatively few of life, that means at each stage of Jesus, once he's dead, it becomes increasingly probable that he'll go on to the next stage of death and decomposition, that he will not be resurrected by God. So here's an objection based on science, too, not on frequencies. So if someone tells you God and science don't mix, in fact, science has strong implications for God. It doesn't say what God can't do. It shows what is unlikely for God to do, okay? So it follows that the prior probability of a specifically supernatural resurrection of Jesus is astronomically low, again, verifying my comment earlier in my grid that the resurrection theory has the lowest plausibility of all. Now, Mike might want to say this, my argument can't be right because prior probability must be based on total evidence, something we don't possess. But that misunderstands the total evidence requirement. The total evidence does not require that the total evidence must be used in reaching a conclusion. That's preposterous because we never have the total evidence on anything. Mike's error here is to leave out the key word available in his book. You never see this, right? What the requirement of total evidence actually states is that the total available relevant evidence must be used in determining the probability of a conclusion. And you get this if you read Wesley Salmon's book on inductive logic, among others. My argument based on the evidence on natural theology states the total available relevant evidence to the resurrection. All this boils down to two points. God has an extraordinarily weak tendency to raise the dead or strong tendency not to raise the dead, and Jesus was dead. Now, what about the skeptic ignores the religio-historical context of the resurrection that Mike brought up? I want to say that's a myth. Do I have five more, or is that includes the five? Okay. What I will do is I'll defer to Mike, and I'll come back and pick up this point following.
Dr. Cavin. At this time, we'll have 2 7-minute rebuttals. Dr. Michael Licona will lead off. Please welcome Dr. Mike Licona back to the podium.
Okay, well, let's just continue with the debate this evening. And again, in my opening statement, I constructed a case for resurrection using two major building blocks, facts and method. I gave 4 facts over here. These still remain uncontested by Greg. And so we just go with method. And this is where we continue to debate this evening, where the issue lies. I presented arguments of inference to the best explanation is how historians work, and we use explanatory scope, explanatory power, less ad hoc, and plausibility. And I've been arguing that the resurrection is by far the best historical explanation in terms of fulfilling those four criteria for the best explanation. Greg Set comes back and he says, well, the resurrection hypothesis does lack explanatory scope and explanatory power because it doesn't describe the resurrection body. That is not scope and power. That has to do, if I were to do that, because I can't go that far as a historian, I can't talk about all the eschatological attributes of Jesus' resurrection body because I just can't do that as a historian. You know, he's saying, I'm supposed to, as a historian, tell what it's like for Jesus in heaven right now? How on earth could I do that? Greg is not schooled in the philosophy of history. He's not a historian. I think we're seeing some of the reasons for some of his arguments in this evening. You can't do this as a historian. It doesn't mean I'm lacking explanatory scope and power. It just means I'm not going beyond what the evidence can bear. And this wouldn't be scope and power anyway. It would be ad hoc. So he's confusing this with the ad hoc criterion. Again, I'm only going as far as the evidence can bear. In terms of ad hoc, he says, well, I challenge Mike to tell us whether Jesus' resurrection body is made of atoms, because if so, it's a weak body. Well, I don't know what Jesus' resurrection body is made out of. I don't know what resurrection bodies are made out of. I don't know what supernatural bodies are comprised of. If they're material, what kind of material, if it's atoms like we have here, if it's a different, since it's a different dimension, what's in that dimension? I can't answer that as a historian, and I'm not going to try to. I could answer it perhaps as a theologian or a philosopher, but not as a historian. So it's not ad hoc. He didn't follow the plausibility anymore, but he did say, he talked about discussing the state of molecules at death. Well, that's fine and everything, but it only tells us what molecules do at the state of death given a natural body that has no intervention by God, period. Now, he says, he wants us to know what his hypothesis is. It's just that Jesus wasn't raised. That's the best hypothesis. Well, and he says that fulfills the criteria for the best explanation better than the others. No, it doesn't. In fact, as Lydia McGrew says, if Jesus did not rise from the dead, the most probable thing to occur is nothing. There's no hallucinations. There's no group hallucinations. Paul doesn't become a Christian, and the Christian movement just falls apart, and we don't have anything today. That's the most probable thing to happen if Jesus didn't rise from the dead. But we have these things. So in other words, let's say Jesus didn't rise from the dead. That's the hypothesis. Would we expect things, or what we would expect would be nothing. But instead, we've got appearances to all his friends, or his followers, in individual and in group settings. We even have one to a foe. We wouldn't expect that. And they come to this conclusion that Jesus has been raised physically, bodily from the dead. That's lacking explanatory power. It can't account for any of these facts, so it lacks explanatory scope. He's not even trying to. I guess you could say it's the plausibility there is that Jesus didn't rise from the dead. It would pass that criterion. And I wouldn't say it's ad hoc either, but I would say it lacks explanatory scope and power. So it would pass two of the criterion. The non-resurrection hypothesis, but you compare that with the resurrection hypothesis, it passes three with flying colors and doesn't fail the fourth. Clearly, the resurrection hypothesis is still superior. Greg says that science tells us that resurrections are astronomically low, and that we live in a physically isolated system, that is a closed universe. But again, science only tells us what happens to the dead, apart from a supernatural cause. In other words, when they're not assisted. In other words, dead critters stay dead apart from the act of God. And in terms of it being a physically isolated system, a closed system, that is a metaphysical assumption he's making there. We don't know that we live in a closed system. And when you look at the laws of thermodynamics, they state clearly in the definition that these apply in a closed system. But what if God decides that he wants to act in our system? All bets are off. The second law doesn't apply to him. And if he's God who creates these laws, he can override them anytime he wants. That's why you can't look at prior probabilities this way. You've got to look at where the evidence lays. And if Jesus rose from the dead, guess what? We live in an open system in which the external agent does act in our system. And ladies and gentlemen, when you see the great evidence we have out there today, he says miracles don't occur. Well, of course they occur. Craig Keener's just written a massive 2-volume set on this, documenting a bunch. I've witnessed miracles. I know people who have been parts of miracles. Miracles do happen today. When you consider the existence of miracles, near veridical apparitions, well-evidenced near-death experiences, of which Gary Habermas can list 100 or more of them, and answered prayer, well, gosh, the evidence for a supernatural realm is so strong today that anyone who denies a supernatural component to reality cannot be a realist. Greg says there is nothing in my hypothesis that says what a body is made of. Well, I did in my book distinguish between a bodily resurrection hypothesis vision, resurrection hypothesis bodily. I assessed both of those by the criteria for the best explanation. And in my book, I show that the resurrection hypothesis bodily outperforms the resurrection hypothesis as an objective vision. That's in my book. 32 seconds, sorry. He says the prior probability is very low for the resurrection. He did not answer about what I said about the U.S. bombing Japan in World War II. You can't calculate a prior probability for that. What's the prior probability of winning the lottery big? That's pretty easy to calculate, about 1 in 100 million. But what's the prior probability of black holes? What's the prior probability of Japan bombing or U.S. bombing Japan with nuclear bombs in World War II? You can't answer that with prior probability. Historians don't use it for that reason. And therefore, the resurrection hypothesis still remains our best explanation. Thanks.
Well, it's obvious that Mike has misunderstood many of my arguments. First of all, I made a careful distinction between physical isolation and causal isolation. I said the universe is not causally isolated from God. I admitted there's a God, and God can intervene in the affairs of the world when he wants to. But the second law of thermodynamics says that God does not intervene in when a system is physically isolated. Mike may not like that, but he has not responded to that point. I asked Mike very pointed questions about the resurrection theory, or as I will call it, the X-Man theory. Mike so far has not explained how the resurrection theory is able to explain the empty tomb or the appearances. He has repeated the claim that it can, but he's not yet shown us how. He says, well, I can't tell you whether it's atoms or schmatoms. Okay, well, if you can't tell us that, then you can't explain to us how it can account for the facts, right? Was Jesus seen with visible light? Mike says, I don't know. Okay, was he seen by some other means? Mike says, I don't know. So Mike is offering us a theory that he himself calls indeterminate. And when you ask him, well, tell us how this explains these things, his answer is, I don't know. So what kind of a theory is it that you say it has scope and power when you ask specific questions about it? The answer is, I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. But there's one thing I do know. It has scope and power. Mike owes us an explanation of what the theory is and how it works. So far, he's given us nothing. And remember, Mike has yet to answer my point earlier on that the way he defines the resurrection theory, he gives a viciously circular explanation of the facts to be explained. Mike actually defined the resurrection theory in terms of the appearances he's trying to explain. Mike has yet to deal with that problem. Mike misunderstood my argument from statistical mechanics, right? He said it only talked about, right, the particles of a dead body. The point is this, that God has no favored microstates. If God has no favored microstates, then they all have equal a priori probability. If they have all equal a priori probability and the dead states outnumber the living states, then Mike has admitted right there that automatically it is highly improbable that God would supernaturally raise Jesus from the dead. Mike tried to answer this, but he showed by what he said he didn't understand my points. So I invite Mike to understand the points and respond to them correctly, in addition, the argument from thermodynamics. Okay, let me go back to the PowerPoint now, if I can. Unfortunately, our machine keeps turning off.
Fair, Mr. Craig, how about if we stop?
Okay, I just want to talk about the so-called religio-historical context that Mike brought up. Right, I got you now. You leave out the evidence concerning the religio-historical context of the resurrection. Well, let's take a look at that supposed evidence. The message, ministry, messianic claims, fulfilled prophecies, miracles, sinless life of Jesus, and how these fit into the Heilsgeschichte of Israel. Mike has repeatedly said all these New Testament historians believe that Jesus did miracles. Well, yes and no. He's taking this out of context. John Dominic Crossan does not believe Jesus did miracles. Marcus Borg does not believe Jesus did miracles. Almost all New Testament scholars believe that Jesus did not do miracles, even though he thought he did and people thought he did. This is simply an unproven claim. By introducing this as evidence, Mike has introduced something inadmissible until he proves that Jesus has done miracles. How is Mike going to prove that Jesus lived a sinless life, right? Jesus was undoubtedly a sinner like the rest of us. There is no evidence that he was sinless. That is simply a dogma of faith. In fact, that's the problem here. These aren't items of evidence. They're simply dogmas of faith. You cannot base an argument on dogmas of faith. James M. Robinson says this of the fulfilled prophecies of the Old Testament, that actually the Old Testament gives us prophecies that the New Testament never fulfills. The New Testament gives us fulfillments that the Old Testament never actually prophesied. You can see this throughout the Gospels if you read carefully. Available evidence must be more probable than its denial. And here's the problem with these items Mike has sought to introduce. Let's take the Loch Ness Monster. You may have read about it recently, that a group of people, a church in the South, is offering the Loch Ness Monster as evidence against evolution. Right, here you go. Well, you can't do that because we don't know whether there is a Loch Ness Monster, right? It's improbable. It can't be used as available evidence. So, bottom line, I'm not denying that Jesus is the Son of God. I'm not denying that he died for our sins or that the resurrection is a super miracle. What I'm saying is Mike has yet to give any evidence for these items. So, because he's not, the only available evidence we have is the evidence I've given you from thermodynamics and from statistical mechanics that God has an overwhelmingly strong tendency not to supernaturally raise the dead and that Jesus died. Those are the only items that we all agree on and know for sure. Even Mike admits that God has an overwhelmingly strong tendency not to raise the dead. So what Mike is going to need to do is give us some evidence to show that these other things are true. Before he does that, though, I'd like him to show me how he can explain the appearances without giving a circular definition. Also, he has not yet dealt with my argument from faith and philosophy in Tet. He mentioned it, but he didn't actually deal with it. Let's move on to one more topic here, and that is the reference class objection. Mike says we can't figure out the probability of dropping bombs in Japan. We can't figure out so many different kinds of prior probability. He's right about this. But it doesn't follow from that we can't figure out this particular prior probability, right? The fact that you can't figure out every prior probability doesn't mean you can't figure out some. In this case, we have sufficient evidence of the prior probability. Right, the fact that you can't figure out every prior probability doesn't mean you can't figure out some. In this case, we have sufficient evidence to figure out what the prior probability of the resurrection is, which is virtually zero. It looks like I'm out of time, so I will come back and finish up with this point when we come back.
Dr. Cavin. Well, at this point, we are going to move into the cross-examination period. And so while we do that, our crew here is going to set up the cross-examination staging. Go ahead and get started with the cross-examination period so that we continue to move forward efficiently with the evening. In this time, we will have Mike begin to examine Greg and ask him questions about the arguments that were raised. Mike will do so for 5 minutes, and then Greg will have the opportunity to examine Mike for 5 minutes,
And we'll have three rounds of this back and forth before we open it up to the audience for Q&A. As you guys, if you guys are a little thirsty, hungry, there's some refreshments in the back that you can help yourselves to as we continue to move forward with the debate. So let's go ahead and get the timer ready for 5 minutes in which Mike will examine Greg on the arguments that have been presented so far. Go ahead, Mike.
Okay, Greg. Hey, one of your main arguments was that you said God respects natural law to the point of never interfering.
I didn't say that.
All right, what did you say?
I said that the second law of thermodynamics makes it improbable that God would act highly. I didn't say it made it that God would never act. In fact, I tried to specifically emphasize the fact that the laws of nature are compatible with God's existence. They don't dictate what God must do, but nonetheless, if the laws are true, they may tell us by natural revelation what God's own will is.
They may tell us, or they do tell us?
Pardon?
They may tell us what his will, or do tell us?
Well, they in fact do say this. If indeed the second law of thermodynamics is a true law of nature, which the evidence seems to show, then that shows us by God's self-revelation that he rarely intervenes supernaturally in the affairs of the world.
Okay, so rarely.
Rarely.
Okay, so you're open to God rarely intervening in the world.
Well, Mike, I think I made that clear from
okay.
the get-go.
Right, I'm just reiterating because, I mean, you had a lot of slides up there and you moved very quickly, so I'm just reiterating this.
Sure.
So in that then, wouldn't, it seems to me that by your model, you are, contrary to what you're saying, you're going by a relative frequency model, that you're saying these things really don't happen that often, and so they're improbable.
No. Relative frequencies are one kind of evidence for statistical statements, but they're not the only kind.
All right, but that's
and
how you based it. That was your argument,
is,
though.
I only brought up the relative frequency argument to respond to something you'd said in your book. My own argument is the scientific argument, which is not based on relative frequencies at all.
Okay, so then how would we know then if you're saying God rarely gets involved in nature? How do you know that apart from statistical probabilities?
Well, you use science, like I said. I talked about...
So science can say that God intervened?
If you look at statistical mechanics, you look at the positive equal a priori probabilities, you look at the number of microstates that correspond
what
to...
What would be those a priori probabilities? I'm sorry.
Well, according to the postulate, all microstates having equal energy have equal a priori probability. Okay, this is a fundamental postulate of statistical mechanics, and it's a postulate that is justified not a priori, but a posteriori by its ability to, for instance, when we watch this glass of water, we don't suddenly see the water boil away.
Right.
Right. We don't see the bottle explode. All that statistical mechanics, that's based on this principle.
And all the statistical analyses that you're doing only applies to natural processes given God's not acting.
No, that's the whole point you're missing. Right. The positive equal a priori probability shows that God has no favored microstates.
But you're making this you're making a theological assumption. The only way that you could even state that was you'd be saying, well, he has that because he doesn't do it that often. We're back to a relative frequency again, Greg.
That's not what I'm saying, Mike. I think as a historian, perhaps you don't have a sufficient background in science and philosophy to understand this, but the postulate entails, right, that God has no favored microstates.
Well, maybe that's what you're doing, but that I don't have to have that postulate in there. I'm going to look at the evidence as a historian, and I see that unique events happen. And if unique events happen, it seems to me that your model is going to rule out unique events, and that's why I think it's naive when it comes to historical investigation.
This is not so at all. I haven't brought up Bayes' theorem yet, but if I were to bring up Bayes' theorem, you can see easily from Bayes' theorem why an event that has a very low initial prior probability can have a very high posterior probability.
You're certainly welcome to bring it up, Greg, but I mean, I'll just say ahead of time that there isn't a single widely respected historian in the universe who uses Bayes' theorem and very good reasons for it, because as I pointed out in my rebuttals, and that there are so many ways that we just cannot, I mean, again, how do you calculate the prior probability of the U.S. dropping a nuclear bomb on Japan in World War II?
Well, it's very interesting. William Lane Craig himself wrote a paper on the tomb of Jesus, arguing that it was not a criminal tomb, and what did he use? He used Bayes' theorem to argue against the claim.
All right, well, I know that, Bill Craig doesn't think that you, he's a personal friend of mine, I know that he doesn't think, regardless of that article, haven't read that article, but he doesn't think that you can use Bayes' theorem for something like the resurrection of Jesus.
Well, but he did think you could use it to show that initially implausible event or improbable event did occur. I was answering your point.
Go ahead and ask one more question, Mike, and then we'll turn it over.
Okay. All right, you said, we look at what God would do and what God has a tendency not to raise people from the dead. And I responded by saying, well, God, he might have a reason for not raising others. Just like with overriding laws, he would have a reason. He wouldn't have a reason to raise my dead grandfather from, raise him from the dead, or many other people. But if this context in which Jesus lived and died were true, that he performed, and I never said that historians are unanimous that Jesus performed miracles. I said historians are unanimous in saying that Jesus performed astonishing deeds that he and his followers regarded as divine miracles and exorcisms. I can't determine whether they were divinely, and scholars will, other skeptics will say, well, he performed psychological healings, or it was magic or sorcery or things like this. They're not saying that they're divine miracles, but we do know from the historical evidence, because it's in every layer of the gospel tradition, Mark, Q, M, L, John, it's in Josephus, it's in Celsus, it's in the Talmud, so it's an unsympathetic, okay, so that's fine. In this kind of context that I established here, it's within this context that Jesus, the evidence comes for him rising from the dead. So I would think God is, we're looking at a specific situation in which God would want to raise Jesus if Jesus was who he claimed to be. And that's a game changer.
Well, here's the thing. In your book, you argue that we can't know what God would want to do.
Yeah, I said it's inscrutable.
You said that God was a free agent.
Yep.
And you got this from Craig in one of his papers. You said that we can't know enough about God to know whether he would or would not want to raise Jesus from the dead.
Right.
Now suddenly you're changing your argument and saying we have enough context to say we can know what God wants to do.
Well, if you call in my opening
statement.
Which
is it? Is it that we can't know that God?
I have changed my mind.
Okay.
And I changed it within probably the last 2 months. As I said in my opening statement, I have wrestled with this over the years, and I've been trying to be fair to think, because of course I want to be able to argue that the resurrection is plausible, but I want to be really honest on this. And, you know, if we can't argue that it's plausible, I'm fine with that. But with this, yeah, I have come to believe over the last few months that we can establish that God would want to raise Jesus from the dead. I think we can build some sort of a case for that, and therefore give the resurrection hypothesis plausibility, but I didn't argue for that.
What
this
is
evening.
Your argument? You guys can continue to talk. I just want to keep structure and
yeah.
flow. Greg, I want to give you 5 minutes, and
okay.
you can continue on your line of thought
all right.
and ask
well,
some questions.
First of all, I want to ask Mike, your definition of the resurrection theory you give on page 500 and whatever it is viciously circular.
Okay.
You include, in terms of philosophy of science terminology and philosophy of history, and by the way, I have studied philosophy of history, your explanans actually is defined in terms of your explanandum. That is to say, you've defined your theory or you defined your cause in terms of your effect. Now, I don't care who the historian is, no historian out there who's worth his salt would ever do that. But you have done that. So what I want to hear from you is, give me a definition of the X-Man theory that does not viciously circularly explain the facts to be explained.
Okay, how about a supernatural cause raised Jesus from the dead?
Okay, now, what do you mean by raised Jesus from the dead?
Okay, Jesus died on the cross.
You mean by he rose from the dead, he died on the cross?
He died on the cross, and then afterward he was raised from the dead. If I'm talking about, now in my book, I'll tell you what, let's make it simple for this evening's debate. God raised, or a supernatural cause, because I can't show it was God, a supernatural cause raised Jesus physically from the dead, bodily from the dead.
So let me ask you this. What was the body made out of?
I have no idea.
Okay, well, by definition, physical means made out of the same kind of chemicals you and I are made out of.
Only if we're talking about this dimension and apart from a supernatural body. You can't tell me that supernatural body, a resurrection body, has the same kind of atoms that we have. Are we really going to split hairs over whether a resurrection body has natural atoms from our universe?
Well, you're missing the point, Mike. You're missing the point.
I think I understand.
In the audience, you're missing the point, too. The point is this. You claim that you can explain the appearances. So far, you've not explained the appearances, right? You say God raised Jesus from the dead. Okay, let's say he did.
And he appeared to them as a physically transformed corpse.
He appeared to them as?
He appeared to them in his physically transformed corpse.
So did this interact with light? Because if it didn't, how could they see him?
Well, I suppose it did. In his physically transformed corpse, light could reflect off of it.
Okay. Well, in that case, he couldn't be immortal.
Well, how do you know that? How do you know that immortal material, resurrection material, can't reflect light?
I know this way. Because by definition, for something to be physical, by definition, is for it to be made of the same kind of atoms you and I are made out of. And the kind of atoms
you and I... Where do you get that definition from? Are you saying that supernatural resurrection bodies can't reflect light? You're going to say you know that for a fact.
What I'm saying is physical bodies... What I'm saying is that for a body to be physical is for it to be made out of hydrocarbons, the same things we're made out of, and there cannot be an immortal body made out of those things.
Why not? That's just a statement you're dropping on us without a shred of evidence.
There's a complete shred of evidence.
Well, give it. Let's hear it.
Okay. We know that carbon atoms bond together with a certain strength. They can be ripped apart.
And resurrection bodies are made of carbon atoms? You know that for a fact?
Well, you just got through saying they were physical.
Yeah, and
okay,
everything physical. So in other words, you're saying
so are you saying
only
they're physical,
physical things.
Or are you saying they're schmizzical? I think you're saying they're schmizzical.
I'm saying resurrection body.
Okay, what I'm saying is you're really saying X-Man.
I'm saying an immortal body, and I am not going, as a historian, to try to describe what a resurrection body is made out of. That would be terribly
Well, then you can't
ad hoc.
Explain. In that case, Mike, though, you can't say that the resurrection body explains the appearances.
Well, sure I can.
No, you can't.
Jesus transformed physical corpse. He's raised from the dead in his transformed physical corpse, and he appears to others because it's physical.
To say he appears to others is what you're trying to explain. You haven't been able to explain how.
Because I can't explain what a resurrection body is comprised of?
Well, try
scientifically?
This. I have a theory. I have a theory that I can't explain to you what it is. I have a name for it. I call it resurrection. I can't tell you what a resurrection is. I can't tell you what kind of a body is. I'll use the word physical, but I won't pin myself down to what I mean by physical. And then I'll say, oh, by the way, it explains appearances because it does. This is not a theory. This has no explanatory scope. It has no explanatory power. I'm sorry,
at
Mike.
At most, all you could do, you could say at most that it's ad hoc, but it doesn't lack power
and
scope.
It's ad hoc.
Physicists do the same thing, Greg. Physicists look at current data, phenomena, and they posit theoretical entities.
For example,
black holes, quarks, strings, gluons.
But they can explain how those things
But they've never seen
explain
them.
The data.
They probably never will. They're theoretical, unobserved entities that
but
explain observable phenomena. Let me just one more thing. History's the same way. The past is unobservable. We look at current phenomena, and we explain the unobservable past. That's why priorities don't work in this way.
What you've given us is a theory sketch.
Greg, can ask one more question. You continue this line of thought, and then we'll switch to the 5 minutes. So go ahead.
Okay. Can I continue the same question?
Yeah, whatever you want.
Again, what you've given us is the name of a theory. You say Jesus had a body. I said, well, is it a body or a schmody?
I said it's physical.
You say it's physical.
Yeah.
What you're doing is you're committing the logical fallacy of equivocation. Equivocation is when people use a word with one meaning, someone else switches it, and gives it a new meaning that no one else has. To say the resurrection, if you say the resurrection body is physical, what do you mean by this?
It's a corpse. The way the not only the Christian literature
Wait,
describes
the living
it,
Jesus is a corpse?
Huh? Not only the way the Christian literature describes it, but the Jewish literature, like Second Baruch, they describe the body. You have a physical body that's buried. That body is raised up, brought back to life, and then it's transformed into an immortal body. Now, I can't describe what that immortal body's like. Was it physical? At least when Jesus wanted it to be. But when Jesus wanted, like if we trust the Gospels on this, and I haven't brought the Gospels into this, but if the Gospels are correct on, say, the road to Emmaus with the disciples, then he could appear and disappear at will. If Luke is correct about Jesus being able to appear behind locked doors at will, then he can disappear and appear at will. When he disappears, is he physical at that point? I have no idea. Probably not at that point. So the resurrection body can do all these kinds of wonderful things.
This is a definition of physics. And again, you're equivocating.
We're going to switch the flow of argument back to Mike examining at this point for a period of 5 minutes.
Okay. All right, Greg, you say that we have sufficient evidence to show that the prior probability of the resurrection hypothesis is extremely low. Give us that again.
Well, I'll give it to you again. First of all, there are three arguments. We do have frequencies, and frequencies work in this case. They don't work in every case. In this case, they work. Beyond frequencies,
explain that
then.
Let's focus on that one for just a moment. So how do frequencies work with this?
Well, let me ask you this. Do you deny that it's unlikely for God to raise the dead generally?
It depends what his motive might be for doing it.
Well, let me ask you this.
I would say he doesn't normally do it.
How many people has God raised from the dead today?
Not many.
Okay. How many did he raise yesterday?
I don't know. I do believe that resurrections do occur today, by the way.
Well,
or I should say divine revivification, resuscitation.
My claim was not that resurrections don't occur. My claim is simply that it is unlikely for God to raise the dead.
Because they don't happen that often, right?
No, not because they don't happen very often.
Well, but that's what you're saying, right?
No, that's what you're saying, I'm saying.
Well, what are you saying then? Just saying God doesn't do it often, and what's the difference between that and me saying you're saying it because it doesn't happen that often, because God doesn't do it often?
I'm not offering as evidence that.
You're saying the prior probability of God raising Jesus is extremely low because God doesn't do it that often.
What I'm saying is God has a particularly weak tendency to intervene supernaturally in the affairs of the world. We see this every day, all of us, all the time. Mike, if you're right and we can't know this, let's watch this bottle of water. I predict that within 5 minutes, God will not supernaturally raise this bottle of water off the table. If you're right, we can't know one way or the other.
All right, so
in fact, if you're right, we could bet right now. I could bet you $300 on this if you're right.
All right, but that's just natural law right here. There's no
that's not natural law.
There's no intent behind it.
Well,
let's
Mike, let's watch God right now. Let's watch God see if he lifts up the bottle.
Well, maybe he doesn't want to do that.
Well, maybe he doesn't. That's not my point, Mike.
He doesn't. Your point is he doesn't do it often.
My point is not whether God wants or not. My point is he's not raising it up.
Greg, I'll be 51 in 2 weeks, okay? Now, this is my first time in Temecula. So I guess it's just not in 51 years, however many days that is in 51 years, this is my first time to Temecula. So I guess you could say it's not really my tendency to come to Temecula. So given this, how often I come to Temecula, I'm not here this evening.
Well, of course, that's not what I'm saying, Mike.
Well, what are you saying?
Well, Mike, Mike's confusing two different kinds of probability. He's confusing prior probability with posterior probability. The prior probability that you had been here tonight is very low indeed. The posterior probability that you're here tonight is very high.
So the prior probability is easily overcome by the evidence.
In this case, yes.
And I would say the same applies to the resurrection. If you want to give the resurrection, you'd say, well, there's a one chance in 100 billion that God would raise someone from the dead. That's easily overcome by the historical evidence we have that the event occurred, given the context in which Jesus lives and dies, who he claimed to be, what he did in terms of astonishing deeds, and then we also have evidence that he did rise from the dead.
Well, it would be if, again, you could show that your hypothesis has, and here you're confusing the issues, explanatory scope, explanatory power. The explanatory scope is the range of facts a theory predicts, explains.
Right.
So far, your theory explains, predicts nothing, because you've given us
the X-Man theory. No, it's not predicts, it explains. Now you're confusing scope and power. Power is the prediction, not scope. Scope is the ability to count all these things.
To be completely honest with you, Mike, the way you define those things, they're confused in your definitions of them.
About the only one that's
you don't
been confused
clear
by them.
Well,
I'm just going by what other historians. These aren't my definitions. These are theirs.
Philosophers of science, philosophers of logic, and philosophers of history disagree with you on this fact. But the fact is...
No, that's not true. The philosophers of history. When was the last time you picked up history and theory?
I have read philosophers of history way back since I was an undergraduate.
Okay.
What you have not shown is that if the resurrection occurred, that we would find likely the empty tomb, the appearances to any degree.
By the way, I have not mentioned the empty tomb this evening.
I know.
So I don't know why you keep bringing
it up. Go ahead and ask one more question. You can follow on this line of reasoning if you want, and then we'll switch it over to Greg examining for a second round of 5 minutes.
Okay. I mean, it seems like I think I've covered just about everything in terms of his major objections here. I mean, he's not disputing the facts. He's disputing how this criterion stuff. Now, I'm using these criteria from the same way a lot of historians, Behan McCullough is the primary one, but other historians talk about these same kind of criteria. I've just adopted their definitions, Greg.
Well, actually,
so you can't say that the majority of the philosophers of history wouldn't say these things. They're the ones I got it from.
You even changed your definition tonight from what you say in your book. You change your definition of ad hoc, for instance. William Lane Craig has different definitions than you do. They're not the same. So
I might have described them a little different, but I don't see that they're different.
Complete agreement on these things. I would ask you to explain to a logician what the difference between explanatory scope and explanatory power is. I don't think you could do it.
Explanatory scope is the ability to account for all the facts, the relevant facts. So imagine a jigsaw puzzle, and you've got all these pieces, and let's say those are historical facts. The solution that I provide, the one that includes the most pieces in the puzzle, is to be preferred. That's explanatory scope. In other words, our relevant bedrock, our knowable facts, we want to include those. The hypothesis that that includes the most of those has the greater explanatory scope. Explanatory power is the ability of a hypothesis to account for those without forcing them to fit or without excessive vagueness or ambiguity. Imagine again our jigsaw puzzle. You know, we've all played this game with the puzzle where you try to fit these pieces. You know it doesn't go there, but you're pushing it. You're making it fit. I think the natural resurrection hypothesis has great or terrible explanatory power. You're forcing it to fit. Or let's say mass hallucinations. Well, it just rarely happens, but this is just one of the cases that a natural mass hallucination happened. That would be lacking explanatory power because you're forcing it to fit. So these are two entirely different criteria.
What do you mean by forcing to fit?
Let's go ahead and shift, and you can continue with that line of questioning,
okay.
Greg, and you've got 5 minutes now to examine Mike.
Well, again, I'm not interested in that line of question. I'm more interested in Mike explaining to us how the resurrection theory explains the facts to be explained. So far, he's given us a viciously circular explanation.
You still think it's viciously circular after I clarified and further defined it?
Well, you have not shown your circular explanation it relates to the facts. Your new explanation that God supernaturally changed the corpse of Jesus into some kind of an unknown living body does not explain how Jesus could be seen.
Well, that's just because I'm not trying to use natural science to explain supernatural entities.
So basically, is this a pixie dust theory?
A what?
Is this what we might call a pixie dust theory? I mean, what you're saying is I can't explain to you how my explanation, I have an explanation, but I can't explain to you what it does, how it works. I can't really explain to you what it says.
I can explain this much, but beyond that, I can't say anything. But my claim is that it has scope and power. What you have yet to show is how it does have scope and power.
Well, I gave four facts.
No, haven't shown how it has those as scope and power.
Well, okay, the resurrection hypothesis accounts for the beliefs of Jesus' disciples that he had been raised from the dead.
How so?
Resurrection hypothesis says Jesus rose from the dead and appeared to others. So it explains why others had experiences
that
they believe.
That?
I don't know what you're asking here.
Well, you say Jesus rose from the dead.
Yeah.
How does that explain the appearances?
Well, if Jesus rose from the dead and did so in confirmation of his claims, then we can see, all right, then all of a sudden you've got appearances.
How?
Well, Greg,
how, Mike?
How can you explain the sinking of the Titanic?
Well, I see you because
I've got eyewitnesses, okay? But how do you explain that they saw it?
I see
you. You've got the sinking of the Titanic. How do you know the survivors really saw it? Well, they're testifying to it.
Because you have a normal physical body.
But that doesn't really explain it.
Well, the reason why is because you can't tell us what kind of a body Jesus has. You might as well say Jesus has a schmaddy. I don't know how these things work, but people can see them.
I'm saying the resurrection body would be a transformed physical corpse and made of supernatural material. It's a supernatural body. Now, I'm not trying to explain
it. So in other words,
it.
By definition, the resurrection body can be seen.
Yeah, by definition, a resurrection body can be seen when the resurrected person wants to be seen.
Your argument becomes viciously circular.
That's not
if
circular.
If you define the resurrection theory to be a body that can be seen and was seen by these people, then this is saying, my explanation is they saw Jesus because they saw Jesus. That's no explanation.
Well Greg, I guess it's one of those things like what comes first? Do you have the hypothesis first and then you look for facts to support it? Or do you look at the facts and formulate the hypothesis? You're going to have the same problem you're mentioning with virtually any hypothesis.
Well, scientific hypothesis and historical hypotheses have to lead to a likelihood or a probability of the facts they're trying to explain.
Yeah.
You haven't done that yet.
Yeah, Jesus
claimed it repeatedly.
Well, the likelihood, you talk Bayes' theorem, given the truth of Jesus' resurrection, if you give the resurrection, then the probability that you would have, let's say, an appearance to Peter or the 12 or to Paul, I think becomes very probable.
Show that. I find that disputable.
Really? Well, how would you dispute it?
Well, because there's no evidence for it.
So
what I would like to know is
except the eyewitness testimony you can't explain.
No. The eyewitness testimony doesn't show that it has this power. That would be, you have to show independently of the facts to be explained that the theory can, in fact, lead to those facts. The feature of the theory itself logically built in is its ability to lead to those facts.
So if the Holocaust happened, how do you do that with the eyewitnesses?
Well, the Holocaust could be seen because this was normal physical bodies with light. You're giving us a supernatural body, which you can't tell us whether it can be seen or not.
And so that's the big thing. No, I did say it can be seen.
Well, you defined it as something that can be seen.
Well, that's because the eyewitnesses said they could see it.
Well, again, Mike, you're just giving a viciously circular explanation.
Well, I don't see it as circular,
Look,
Greg.
I could say I have an unknown thing, but there's one thing I can say about it. It can be seen. Well, that's not an explanation.
Now, if you said that you had an apparition appear to you at night of a loved one that had been deceased for 5 years, and that apparition talked to you, and let's say they communicated information to you that you couldn't have known otherwise, and you're able to relate that information. And I say, well, Greg, what was the apparition made of? I don't know. Well, your argument's viciously circular then. How could I even believe what you're saying there? You can't even describe what it's made out of.
That sounds right to me.
Okay, well.
I mean, here, I have a theory. I can't explain what it is. All I do is I define it so that it can explain the facts to be explained. That doesn't sound like much of a theory.
Well,
Scientists don't work that way.
There are many cases like this of these veridical apparitions where they do appear and they do communicate information, accurate information the person could have known otherwise, I'm not going to deny the occurrence of the event simply because I can't talk scientifically on the nature of the body and what it's made of, whether light can reflect off of it.
I'm not asking you to explain scientifically. What I'm asking you is to give any explanation of how these things could be seen.
And if I did that, I'd be terribly ad hoc.
We're going to go ahead and shift into our final round of examination. Mike, you can now examine Greg for 5 minutes.
I'll just pass on this. I'll let Greg do it because I think we're just at an impasse here. Either I'm not really communicating with him or he's not communicating with me, or one of us is being really stubborn and not admitting things, but I think we're at a kind of standstill here. I just don't see the legitimacy of his arguments. So I really don't have anything else to say.
Well, what I would say is I've given an alternative explanation that Jesus did not rise from the dead. They can account for the appearances as well as your theory can, because you haven't shown how yours can. It's more plausible. So I have an explanation that is far superior to yours.
And
so we
give
should
me
accept
that explanation
the hypothesis
again.
That Jesus did not rise from the dead.
That's your hypothesis, Jesus did not rise.
It's just as good as yours, because your hypothesis is even more indefinite than mine.
Well, it isn't as good, because, again, I said, if Jesus didn't rise, the most probable thing to happen is nothing. You don't get any appearances. Maybe you get one out of the bunch. You may get one appearance. You have no group appearances. You don't have the appearance of Paul. And those are our facts. So the non-resurrection hypothesis has terrible explanatory scope. If Jesus didn't rise, we don't expect any of these, so it has terrible explanatory power. It's not ad hoc. I wouldn't say it's ad hoc, and I wouldn't say it's implausible. But it certainly fails two of the four criteria for the best explanation, whereas the resurrection hypothesis, contrary to your claims, passes three of the four with flying criteria and doesn't fail the fourth.
Well, if Jesus rose from the dead, you don't necessarily have an expectation that he would be seen.
Well, if he
did, might be, he might not be.
If he did in confirmation of his claims, and I've argued not only in my book, as you know, but also in the Journal for the Study of the Historical Jesus, that the Jesus predictions pertaining to his death and resurrection are historical. I provided six arguments for these. So if Jesus actually predicted his death and resurrection in confirmation of his claims, then we would expect the appearances.
If. But again, that's an ad hoc hypothesis.
That's not ad hoc. I provided evidence.
Well, many historians disagree with you that Jesus didn't predict his...
Many historians disagree with you with Bayes' theorem. It doesn't mean that they're wrong or right. We're not looking for a universal consensus here.
How do you explain the evidence of Paul on your theory?
What do you mean?
Well, Paul saw Jesus as a blinding light up in heaven. The resurrection says Jesus is down here.
Yeah. Post-ascension appearance.
How do you get him up there?
Post-ascension appearance.
Post-ascension.
He's in his glorified state.
So now we have to add to the resurrection hypothesis yet another supernatural hypothesis of an ascension. And where exactly is Jesus now?
Well, according to the scriptures, he's in heaven. But I'm not going to argue that for historically. You asked me a theological question about Paul and why he thought. And by the way, if we can go two ways with Paul. We can go Paul on Paul. In other words, Paul using Paul's writings. Or we can do Luke on Paul, Luke and Acts on Paul. John Dominic Crossan and Jonathan Reed are so strong in thinking that Paul was teaching bodily resurrection that they said we can bracket the book of Acts, just bracket it, throw it aside, and go with what Paul says on resurrection, and he believes that he saw an appearance of the physically raised Jesus. So I've only used Paul's writings tonight, and so if we do that, and I showed how Paul believes in bodily resurrection, so we get bodily resurrection with Paul without him describing the appearance. If we go with Acts, he talks about a glorious appearance of Jesus, but the nature of that appearance was such to him that he still interpreted as the physically raised Jesus. And if you grant Acts 9, you also grant Acts 13, where Paul says, David died according to Psalm 16. It says, you will not allow your son or your body, your holy one, to decay. David died, was buried, his body decayed. Jesus died, buried, his body did not decay, but God raised it, and of that were eyewitnesses. So Paul does believe, whatever the nature of those experiences were, Paul was convinced Jesus was raised physically, bodily, from the dead.
So the question was not answered, and that is, how exactly did Paul see Jesus?
I don't know. But with the nature of
the... I have an explanation. I don't know.
But the nature of the
experience... What kind of explanation is that?
The nature of whatever that experience was convinced him that Jesus had been raised physically.
That could be a hallucination. A hallucination.
He wasn't grieving. He wasn't a good candidate for hallucination. He wasn't grieving over Jesus' death. Jesus would have been the last person in the world Paul would have wanted to see.
I think Paul could have hallucinated, but that's not the point. The point is this. You still haven't explained how the resurrection theory explains Paul's appearance.
You give Paul himself.
Okay, let's say Jesus is up in heaven. How does Paul see him?
Well,
I don't know.
Yeah. I mean,
okay,
if we take the Acts account,
you have an explanation. I don't know.
If we take the Acts account,
I have great explanatory scope, I have great explanatory power, but I don't know how it works. That is not an explanation. That's not how historians work. That's not how science works. That's just pixie dust theory.
We don't know how a lot of things in science work, Greg. And I mean, until recently, it's like we can't figure out how wave and particle work together. They seem contradictory, and yet science says, well, there's got to be some way for that to work.
Well, actually, we have a mathematical theory. It's called quantum mechanics, accurate to 7 decimal places. We understand that exactly. But you can't even give us any explanation at all of how it was that Paul could be down here and see Jesus up there. And yet you claim that you have scope and you have explanatory power. I'm not saying
scope and power. I don't have to explain everything about everything in order to have scope and power.
You said you could explain these four facts.
Yep.
You can't explain one of them.
I don't have to explain everything about him. I can explain Jesus died by crucifixion. I don't have to explain the atoning nature of that in order to have explanatory scope and saying that Jesus died.
You say you can explain the appearance to Paul. You haven't explained it.
I said that Paul had an experience that he interpreted as the risen Jesus appearing to him, and that he believed Jesus had been raised physically from the dead.
We agree. But your theory can't explain that. It doesn't lead to any expectation.
I can't explain the nature of the experience in terms of what Paul actually saw in detail unless I take the Acts account.
I'm not asking you to explain the nature of the experience. I'm simply asking you to show me how, on your theory, this experience would be explained. You just keep repeating that you have, but you haven't done it.
I think you're asking for things that historians just can't do, Greg. It's just unrealistic.
Okay, well...
It's unrealistic expectations.
I think then what you mean by explanation, what you mean by scope and power, are not, for instance, what logicians mean by these things. And you keep deferring to historians. I think ultimately it's logicians who have the top say. If a historian says, if someone says this is how historians work, but it violates the canon of logic, then I'm going to go with the logicians, not the historians.
Well, I would too if it violates the canons of logic, but I fail to see where it's done that, Greg.
Well, I would suggest you read a book by Irving Coppi and a book by Quine and Ullian that go into the criteria of adequacy you use. They give different definitions than you give, and they are top logicians.
Well, they may be, but they're not philosophers of history. And philosophers of history use the four criteria for the best explanation.
Well, in that case, it means logic doesn't matter. History wins.
No, it means logic matters. It means your guys aren't thinking the same way as historians do.
With that, we're going to go ahead and wrap up with some closing statements. So we're just going to reposition the stage one last time, and then we're going to have 2 5-minute closing statements. Mike will start, Greg will finish, and then we'll open up to Q&A.
We will go ahead and call Dr. Michael Licona up to the podium for his final closing statement. Dr. Licona.
Well, thank you. I've enjoyed this evening, and despite our spirited exchanges, I've really enjoyed this, and I respect Greg, and this is fun, and we've talked about catching a meal together when I come back out and teach at Biola this fall, and I'll look forward to that. This has been fun, and I'm glad we could have a collegial time despite our sharp disagreements. In my opening statement, I did present, again, a positive historical case for the resurrection of Jesus using two major building blocks. facts and method. I'd like to just assess how we fared in tonight's debate. Concerning our facts, I presented four facts. Number one, shortly after Jesus' death, a number of his followers had experiences they interpreted as the risen Jesus appearing to them. Two, these experiences happened in both individual and in group settings. Three, a persecutor and skeptic named Paul had an experience that he believed was an appearance of the risen Jesus who appeared to him. And four, the nature of their experiences were such that they concluded that Jesus had been raised physically, bodily from the dead. Now, none of those went disputed this evening. What we did go with is our method now, and how do we explain these? And in my method, I said that historians employ arguments of inference to the best explanation and use four general criteria for assessing hypotheses in this manner. Explanatory scope, the ability of a hypothesis to account for all the relevant facts. I showed how the resurrection certainly does this. Explanatory power, can it do it without forcing him to fit? Would we expect these? And yeah, I think it would. It has great explanatory power, resurrection hypothesis. Ad hoc, is this something that we would think true other than it explains the facts? And I said, given the resurrection, the truth of the resurrection, yeah, we would expect these kinds of things to happen. There's no non-evidenced assumptions in here. We would expect these things. There's no improvisation that has to be involved here. And finally, plausibility. Plausibility assesses the degree to which a hypothesis is compatible with our relevant background knowledge. We know our relevant background knowledge tells us that the dead aren't raised unassisted or by natural causes. But there's nothing from science or medicine that tells us that a supernatural being like God could raise someone from the dead. Just as historians can't tell whether Jesus' death atones for sins, scientists can't tell anything about what a supernatural being would not do. Now, Greg takes issue with this, and he says, well, no, the laws of science, natural law, tell us what God would want to do. Well, I think this is a non-evidenced assumption right here. There's no evidence. You'd have to know God's mind to know this. You'd have to know that God wouldn't want to ever override the laws of nature. He says, well, yeah, but God doesn't do it that often. Well, that doesn't mean anything. I mean, really, again, we don't find nations nuking other nations that often either. But that doesn't mean the United States didn't drop nuclear bombs on Japan in World War II. You can't use prior probability in historical investigation. He says that we can, but we can't. Historians don't do that. It's the wrong tool. He's not trained. He might have read some books on the philosophy of history, but he's not using or going by that method. We just don't. It's the wrong tool. It's like bringing a calculator to an archaeological dig. It doesn't work. Well, then he says those were his two big things. He did say about the natural resurrection hypothesis, or actually, he said that the most probable thing to happen would be Jesus didn't rise from the dead. Well, naturally speaking, yes, but not supernaturally speaking. We have to look at intent here. I mean, there's billions of women in the world. I married one. Does that mean the prior probability of my marrying my wife was one in however many billion? No. I mean, there's intent there, there's reason, there's reasons for why we do things. God, if the New Testament is correct, God would want to raise Jesus and not others. He would want to raise Jesus because this was his divine son. He would want to do it to corroborate Jesus' teachings, to put a stamp of approval on it. There's nothing unlikely at all about this from a supernatural perspective. And again, if you're saying that supernatural doesn't happen today, I think given all the evidence out there from miracles, evidence, near-death experiences, veridical apparitions, answered prayer, you can't be a realist if you deny the supernatural out there today. So we can see that my case for the resurrection of Jesus still stands, and Greg's case to the contrary has failed under critical scrutiny.
Thank you, Dr. Licona. And now we will have Dr. Cavin's closing statement to wrap up this evening's debate. Please welcome yet again Dr. Cavin to the podium.
Well,
As you can tell, I disagree with Mike. I agree with Mike's four facts. That's not the issue. I do disagree with him on methodology. We haven't talked about the Bayesian approach. What Mike doesn't know is that Brian Skirms and other philosophers have shown that unless plausibility and these other criteria are probabilities, they're irrational. I don't know if historians know this or not. I don't know how much logic historians read. But this has been shown. So ultimately, if Mike can't fit what he has into Bayes' theorem, it shows that logically and probabilistically this is incorrect. In fact, Dutch books can be made against Mike where he will lose everything he owns and he'll think it's fair that he loses it this way. We didn't have time to talk about that tonight, but I thought I'd bring it up briefly now. Mike repeatedly says the X-Man theory, as I'm going to call it, explains the facts. But I kept pinning Mike to the ground to try to tell me what the X theory was, the X-Man theory. Basically, what Mike repeated over and over again is, I can't tell you anything about it except God changed a corpse. Well, what did he change it to? Well, physical. What do you mean by physical? Well, I don't know. I won't tell you what I mean by physical. Basically, what Mike did was he evaded all of my questions. Now, if I gave you an explanation or a proffered explanation, you said, well, explain to me how that works, and I couldn't do it, you wouldn't say to me, well, Cavin, you don't have to go into the details. You'd press me for the details. What you can see here is that Mike's theory leads to no expectation that we would have an empty tomb. We have no idea what a Jesus made of atoms or schmadoms would do. We have no idea if he would appear to the women. We have no idea whether he would flee from the women. Maybe Jesus in his earlier life had predicted that he would rise from the dead. Maybe once he rose from the dead, he said, my God, look, I'm alive again. I'm happy. I don't want to live that life I lived. Maybe he would forsake the disciples. Maybe he would not. We simply don't know what a risen man would do because we have no experience of what the resurrected do. The only case we would have is Jesus, and it begs the question here to say we would know what he would do. So again, I would say to Mike, if he's Adams, we can see him, but then he can't be immortal. Then he would be stuck down on earth. He couldn't appear to Paul. Mike never answered that point. If Jesus is Adams, then he cannot appear to Paul. On the other hand, if Jesus is Schmadams, he can't even interact with the universe at all. He couldn't be seen. So either way, we do not have a good explanation of the four facts that Mike wants to explain. I also argued that the resurrection is highly astronomically improbable based on the assumption that God exists, that God has supernatural power. What I argued on three different reasons, frequencies, and two scientific theories. One is thermodynamics and one is statistical mechanics. And I could have talked about quantum mechanics, but we didn't have time. That it is astronomically unlikely that God interferes supernaturally to do anything at all, let alone raise the dead. So if we put these facts together, what do we get? Mike's X-Man theory is a big question mark. We really don't know what it is. Okay, he's indefinite about that. Because of that, it can't have explanatory scope. It can't have explanatory power. To have those, Mike will have to add a variety of ad hoc assumptions, making his resurrection theory highly ad hoc. It has a low plausibility. It also has a relatively low, illumination. Now, let's take a look at the theory that Jesus did not rise from the dead. That theory, I grant Mike, is a very poor explanation. But it's not as poor as a theory that's an X-Man theory. An X-Man theory leads to no expectation of these facts at all. Even a crazy mass hallucination theory leads to some expectation that we would get an empty tomb and that we'd get appearances. So what I want to argue is, as bad as the naturalistic alternatives are, the resurrection theory does poorly still. Even if it only does that much poorly, it's still poorer. On the other hand, the naturalistic theories have a super high plausibility. We put all that together, the non-resurrection theory wins and is overall the theory that best satisfies Mike's criteria of explanatory scope, power, plausibility, illumination, and plausibility. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Cavin. Again, we're going to reset the stage one last time. It'll take us about a minute, and then we're going to move into your questions for the last 30 minutes of this evening's discussion. So stick around. That always promises to be a very fascinating part of the debate, and we will move into that in about 1 minute. Okay, well, let's come back together for the final 30 minutes of what has already been a very exciting debate. With that, and before we get into the questions from the audience, Scott Waterbury, we have your insurance card. So if you're still here, you know Scott. We'll be able to get you your insurance card after this Q&A session. Well, we'll start now with the questions, and I'd just like to open up with a question, and then we'll put some basic guidelines on the Q&A period. These are the debaters tonight, not you, and so let's leave the questions up to being actually questions, and so they shouldn't be mini lectures or mini debates in themselves, but just try and keep it concise, not these big, long, elaborate explanations, but concise question that's clear and that they're able to answer no more than 1 minute to be certain, and then they're going to each have 2 minutes to respond to the questions, and that'll allow us to get through quite a few questions. And so I'll open up with one. It'll be for Dr. Cavin, and then Mike can talk to that as well.
Yep.
So Greg, you took issue with Mike's saying that Christ having a resurrection body is not a well-defined thesis. But take, for example, the theory of quantum mechanics. There are at least six, maybe more, interpretations of quantum mm-hmm. theory that can be divided into deterministic and indeterministic models. For example, deterministic models such as the Copenhagen theory. Now, because...
That's indeterministic.
Yeah, right. So we have this agnosticism, perhaps, between... Maybe I come to quantum theory, and maybe I'm agnostic about whether it's deterministic or indeterministic. That doesn't mean, it seems to me, that we throw out quantum theory. How, then, is that different, accepting quantum theory, but remaining agnostic on whether it's indeterminate or determinate? How is that different than accepting the resurrection thesis, yeah. but remaining agnostic on the precise kind of body, atoms or schmatoms?
Here's how that's different. Quantum mechanics, although it has seven different interpretations, you're talking about David Bohm's deterministic interpretation, yes? Quantum mechanics has a mathematical formalism that leads to definite predictions. To seven decimal places, the most accurate scientific theory we've ever had. Mike's resurrection theory doesn't do anything even remotely like that. Now, of course, I don't expect Mike to give us quantum mechanics, but what I do expect is Mike to give a theory where he can show how it leads to the facts to be explained. Quantum mechanics, no matter what interpretation you take, the mathematical formalism shows how it leads to the facts to be explained. If I have a theory that, if I see Caesar crossing the Rubicon, I can give you a theory where I can explain how I see that. Because Caesar is made out of atoms, and photons hit his atoms, they're absorbed, they're emitted, they come into my retina, et cetera, so forth. You know the story. See, there I have a theory that explains how it is, why it is that I see Caesar crossing the Rubicon. Mike can't do this with his theory. Mike gives us the X-Man theory, which is simply a blank waiting to be filled in with a genuine theory. All Mike can say is that God did something to the corpse of Jesus. What he did, Mike cannot say. So the analogy is actually a bad analogy with quantum mechanics, because there we have the formalism that's the same for all seven interpretations.
I guess I'd respond that this is just indicative of Greg bringing the wrong tools to the table. He's not a historian. He's talking about quantum mechanics that is based in mathematics. You can't bring mathematics to history. It's a different discipline. Again, it's the wrong tool. It's like using a telescope to detect cancer. It's just the wrong tool. You don't have a physician bring his MRI machine in order to find out what's wrong with his car. It's just the wrong tool. By asking me to explain what is a supernatural body composed of, and then because I can't answer that, he calls it the X theory, then therefore I'm not supposed to be able to say as a historian or even say it's a supernatural body. I mean, if quantum physicists are disagreeing and have six different models on how it works, I mean, obviously they're all not so predictable, or if that's the case, they've got to reassign or readjust their method if that's what's going on. But you just don't apply mathematics to history. It is the wrong tool.
Good. Thank you, Mike. And we'll just start back in the back there with you, sir. Go ahead and ask your question.
My name is Jeffrey Frischner, and I'm a believer for about 26 years. I'm Jewish, but I became a believer. And this is a very important discussion for me, because I actually felt that the Father God spoke to me at that point. And so I've been working out my faith for 26 years. And it seems like the basis for what I've understood from
Who's the question directed toward?
Well, really both of you. Okay. But it's about the essential of the Christian faith called the resurrection. And whether or not that... And I love the fact that this discussion tonight, because it seems like that has come into question, or whether that is actually, because that's the Apostles' Creed, and in the Apostles' Creed, and it does seem the basis for that seem to be testimonies. A historical basis for it is to our testimonies. So, but yet there doesn't seem to be probability for it, but yet you seem to be a believer, Dr. Cavin, correct?
Am I a believer?
Yes.
No.
Oh, you're not?
No.
You're not a believer?
No, I'm not a believer. I'm an apostate.
You were a believer at one time.
I was.
So,
it was the study of the evidence for the resurrection that led me to disbelief.
So, the question is, can you be a believer, I guess, for you, Andrew, and you, Dr. Licona, can you be a believer and not believe in the resurrection?
No. The Apostle Paul wrote, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. So resurrection, belief in Jesus' resurrection is one of those necessary or essentials for salvation.
Greg, what do you think? You think it's necessary?
Well, I don't think there's salvation. So I do believe there's a God. At least I have a 50-50 percent belief in God. I believe that when we all leave tonight, whether Jesus rose or not, we're not.
Okay, great, thank you. Next question. Yes, sir.
Thank you guys very much for coming tonight. I've been listening all night, and it sounds that you're having two entirely different arguments. One is historical, which seems to have the only basis of fact, is testimonials. The other is based on probability. So my question, if the Bible attests to Jesus the whole time, you talked about prophecy, that there are some that haven't come true. You didn't back that up with anything. You went to the next point. So if it's not true, then what about all the evidence that they're saying? All these testimonials, people saying that they actually did see him bodily risen, that Thomas touched the holes in his hands, that Jesus ate broiled fish, that they actually recognized him, not his, the Adams, the Schmadams. They didn't recognize Schmadams, they recognized a man. And in I mean, it doesn't seem like you've addressed that at all. And in regards to probability, I just like to quote Mark Twain. He said there are lies, damn lies, and statistics.
Dr. Cavin, I think that's for you.
I did not detect a question.
The question is about the historical accuracy, whether you believe there is any historical accuracy for the actual testimonials in the Bible, which is the entire argument that...
He's asking, is there the ability to construct a reliable historical picture of Jesus from the New Testament?
Of course there is. So, I would agree with N.T. Wright's reconstruction to a large degree. In fact, I think N.T. Wright plays nicely into the hands of the anti-resurrectionist.
And Mike, what do you think?
Well, I think when it comes to the resurrection narratives in the Gospels, I mean, I believe they're reliable. But there are a lot of part of it that I can't prove as a historian. And I mean, there are just certain things in the Bible we can prove, you know, with better certainty. We can prove Jesus was crucified. I believe that we can prove that he rose from the dead. I can't prove his virgin birth. I can prove that he did deeds that appeared to be miraculous in nature. I can't prove that he walked on water. Does that mean I don't believe it? No, but I believe it by faith, not because historical investigation, you know, yields that sort of conclusion.
Thank you. Okay, great. Thank you for that question. Josh, what's your question?
Hi, my question's for Greg. You say you are for proper methodology as logic. You say that there is not enough probability of God raising Jesus from the dead because of no prior examples of God doing so. But my question is, it seems you have failed to address the prior historical evidence of prophetic history in which Jesus spoke he was fulfilling, including his life, death, and resurrection. Therefore, isn't there a greater probability based on pre-historical writings of God's will for Jesus that God's will was to raise Jesus from the dead based on prior prophetic scriptures, and Jesus himself saying he was fulfilling those scriptures, including he was saying he was God and would be acting as God in full power and after being risen from the dead. Based on this prehistorical explanation by the scriptures, how can you say there was no expectation? You have failed to address the prophecies of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection as historical probability. My question is why? Does not this alone create higher plausibility that the expectation of God was to raise Jesus from the dead as immortal?
Okay, thanks, Josh. Greg, why doesn't Old Testament prophecy and Jesus' own prophecies create an expectation that God would raise him?
I did mention the view of James Robinson, who speaks for so many scholars, that the Old Testament gives us prophecies that the New Testament never fulfills. The New Testament gives us fulfillments the Old Testament never prophesies. For instance, in the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus comes riding in on two donkeys. That's because the author of Matthew misunderstands Hebrew synonymous parallelism. He sees it repeated twice in the Hebrew. The Hebrew is only talking about one event. The author of Matthew completely misunderstands synonymous parallelism. You end up having Jesus ride in on two donkeys in Matthew, not in Mark or Luke. That's an example of a prophecy that the Old Testament doesn't make that the New Testament fulfills. Matthew is full of things like this. There is nothing in the Old Testament that prophesies the coming of the kind of Messiah Jesus was supposed to be. I think N.T. Wright is correct that Jesus basically redefined what Messiahship was. There's nothing in the Hebrew scriptures that prophesies that Jesus would rise from the dead, nothing. So that's not going to help us here. I believe that Jesus probably predicted something based on possibly the Jesselson stone. He had some kind of a belief, I believe, that he would become alive again after he died. But certainly, that's not enough evidence to change the low, otherwise prior probability we have for the resurrection theory. By the way, if you look behind me on that table, you'll see that my glass of water or my bottle of water is still on the table. It hasn't risen up once. And by the way, if God wanted it to, if he willed for it to, it would have risen. Right now, I can tell you categorically, God does not want that bottle to rise off the table. If he did, believe me, whatever God wants happens. It's stuck to that table.
What do you think, Mike? What about prophecy?
I would agree. I would agree, first of all, that God probably doesn't want that bottle to raise off the table, or it would. And likewise, he probably doesn't want the majority of the 100 billion people who have lived on the earth to raise at this point, or he would have done it. But there's no reason for him to have wanted to do it. There are reasons for him to have wanted to raise Jesus from the dead if Jesus was who he claimed to be, and that's the game changer. In terms of prophecy, I haven't been a student of prophecy. I remember looking at a lot of the things that people were claiming were prophecies, like Jesus fulfilled over 300, and I wasn't impressed with the overwhelming majority of what they were claiming. I haven't been a student of prophecy. I do think that there's some really cool stuff in Isaiah and the Psalms that seem to talk about the death of Jesus. However, I do find it hard to see stuff that relates to his resurrection. I do think, as a historian, though, that makes it kind of interesting, because one of the main scriptures that the New Testament authors quote would be Psalm 16:10 that says, "You will not allow your Holy One to see decay." That psalm was written of David. And so for the Christians to claim that as a fulfillment of prophecy for Jesus is remarkable, in my opinion, because it's like they would have claimed it, and the Jew of that day would have said, "Are you kidding? That's referring to David, and God did rescue him from death. He didn't allow his body to see decay, meaning he didn't allow him to die, but we saw Jesus crucified." The only reason that the Christians would use that in the earliest part of the church is because they had some experiences that really convinced them Jesus had been raised from the dead. They went to the scriptures to try to make sense of it, and that's the verse that they made sense of it. So it's almost like they kind of had to force it, the prophecy there, going back based on their experiences of the risen Jesus. And that just seems to just convince me more that I think that's a good argument to show that the disciples truly had experiences that they believed were appearances of the risen Jesus.
Great. Thank you, Mike. We're going to take one more question, and the discussion can continue among yourselves. Mike will be around, and so will Greg, at least shortly after this, so you can continue to talk to them as well. Go ahead, Chris, I believe it is. Is that Chris? I can't see back there. Go ahead with your question, though. No, the person with the mic, yeah.
Okay. Dr. Cavin, in the beginning of your talk, you said their first premise was that God, it's unlikely for God to raise someone from the dead. Jesus was dead, therefore God did not raise Jesus from the dead. Mm-hmm. And then you said that you agree with the Western theistic view of God. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if that's maybe the problem of your argument, is that what if you changed your view of God to not the Western theistic, which says that God is upstairs and humanity is downstairs and God has no intervention, but the Jewish Israel view of God, which says that heaven and earth are interlocking realities, and they would point to creation, the temple, the covenants, and so on. And this is where I would like for you guys to respond to Wright's argument for the resurrection, which is that Christianity was a movement that proclaimed the kingdom of God had come. And the perceptions of the kingdom of God in first century Judaism was that the temple would be built, enemies would be defeated, and so on. I'm sure Michael Licona could name the rest for me. Yet, the Christians believe that the kingdom of God had to come. What's the explanation for that? How did you get, and yet the temple was not rebuilt. You know, the Rome was still in power. What would have happened, and Wright would say, the resurrection. What's your response to that?
Well, your argument, your question is very complicated, but it seems to me that you misunderstand what I meant by generic Western monotheism. Western generic monotheism includes Christianity, Judaism, Zoroastrianism, and Islam. All those religions believe exactly what you were talking about. So I think you simply misunderstand what Western generic monotheism is, right? It's simply the disjunction of Judaism, Zoroastrianism, Christianity, and Islam. Now, if you want to repeat the second part, you start talking about the temple and things like that. I wasn't sure what you were driving at.
I guess I was just asking, like Wright would say, the beliefs about God in first century Judaism was that the enemies would be destroyed and the temple would be rebuilt. And so, so Christianity became a movement that proclaimed the kingdom of God had come, which should mean the temple should be built and the enemies be destroyed. But that didn't happen. So how did they become a movement to proclaim the kingdom of God had come, even though those things didn't happen?
And Wright was saying, and I don't disagree about one thing. I agree with him. I've believed this for years, that there's no doubt the disciples believed they had seen Jesus. No doubt about this. No doubt that the Christian movement sincerely believed that Jesus had risen from the dead. At least they used that expression. Exactly what they meant by that is a more open question that even Mike, he leaves it ambiguous in his book on purpose because scholars are not agreed on that. So the question is not, I think, what you ask. The question is not, did they really believe? And certainly that explains the fervor and everything that happened afterwards. There's no doubt that the rise of the early church can be traced back to their belief. The question is, what caused their belief? And to repeat myself once again, Mike has not really given a hypothesis that gives an explanatory cause. And he can bring up history and all this all he wants, but just by the ordinary, more basic fundamental criteria of logic, he simply has not given what logicians would call an explanation. And I'm sure that if we had secular historians in here who were listening to him, they would say, you know what? That's not the way we apply those criteria.
Mike, how is your theory different from an explanatory cause and not a hypothesis at all?
I want to say that Greg's hypothesis doesn't explain it either. He doesn't explain the origin of the church or how they came, the expansion of the church. He doesn't explain how the appearances happened by saying Jesus didn't rise from the dead. His hypothesis explains absolutely nothing. So it has no scope. It has no power. It's not really a hypothesis. He can say Jesus didn't rise, but he hasn't told us that he think that. What were these appearances? Were they hallucinations? What were they? So he hadn't told us anything. And so remember, when we're comparing hypotheses, let's just say he's right. I think he's wrong in saying the resurrection hypothesis doesn't have explanatory scope or power. But even if he's right in saying it lacks it, it still has greater explanatory scope and power than what his has. Because at least mine tries to explain something, his doesn't. His just says Jesus didn't rise. And hypotheses go by which one has greater explanatory scope, which one has greater explanatory power. He says, historians, secular historians would disagree with me and how I'm applying the criteria. Well, Behan McCullough is a prominent secular historian and a philosopher of history. And he is on record as saying that the resurrection hypothesis has great explanatory scope and great explanatory power. Now, he happens to think it's ad hoc and lacks some plausibility, and he and I have locked horns on this in the forthcoming issue of the Southeastern Theological Review. So it's something that we can disagree on, but there's a historian there, a secular historian, philosopher of history, who says resurrection hypothesis has great explanatory scope and power.
Greg, do you want to give a closing comment, and then we'll wrap things up?
Well, I just wanted to say in response to that again, between a theory where I say he simply didn't rise from the dead, very unspecific theory, I grant, and an X-Man theory where we don't even know how it works, clearly my theory must have, although very, very weak explanatory power and scope, still it must have superior, even slightly, to Mike's. And because my theory has greater plausibility than his for the reasons I've given, and is no more ad hoc than his. Again, my hypothesis satisfies Mike's criteria of adequacy far better than his own theory.
Well, thank you. That brings our 30 minutes of Q&A to a close. I'd just like to thank Dr. Greg Cavin for being with us.
Thank you very
evening.
Much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Licona.
Thank you. Mike, thank you.
It was a fun debate. Enjoy it.